Just rolling along, I'm quitting the blues of the world. Just singing a song, singing a song. Hallelujah, I just phoned the parson. He parked, ready to call. Just like Humpty Dumpty, I'm ready to fall. I'm sitting on top of the world. Just rolling along, rolling along.
Good morning, Columbia. This is Les Paul. Hi, Scooter. Hi, gang. We're proud of you. Wish you all the luck in the world up there. Don't get a speeding ticket or any of that stuff. Black and this.
Hey, good morning, Houston. Thank you very much for that. Wow. We're having a great time up here on top of the world, and we really thank Les Paul for thinking of us and glad to get his support. So we appreciate that morning wake-up music, and it's a great way to get going. We had a good day yesterday, and now we're ready to press ahead and finish this thing up.
So you're looking at one of the two new solar arrays, the Port Solar Array on the Hubble Space Telescope, which was installed on Tuesday morning by Newman and Massimino. The commanding being sent to reposition the arrays to provide the best access possible throughout the course of the morning this morning for Jim Newman and Mike Massimino. Looking up the 43.5-foot long Hubble Space Telescope, this view being provided to show the area where a thermal blanket, the new outer blanket layer insulation was installed the other day. By Newman and Massimino as a so-called get-ahead task. They were able to take advantage of some time to lay that blanket on the Hubble Space Telescope over one of the sensitive equipment bays. There may be another opportunity, if things go well this morning, for them to lay another blanket over another area yet to be determined on the telescope, just to shore up its thermal insulation over some of its sensitive scientific and engineering instruments.
Howdy, Digger.
Okay, I kicked them out so I can get back to work.
Commander Scott Altman, as he prepares to back up Nancy Curry on the shuttle's robot arm this morning.
They'll try to install a camera on the Hubble telescope. On Wednesday, the astronauts gave the observatory a new central power unit. The old one had a loose connection that sometimes caused malfunctions. One day after putting a new control panel on the 12-year-old Hubble telescope, they're adding a new camera. The camera is expected to increase the observatory's discovery capability tenfold. Astronaut John Grunsfeld said the control panel added Wednesday gives the shuttle the power to see to the edge of the universe, and that the camera will give it the eyes so it can see just that. Pretty spectacular stuff, although I don't think Richard will admit that. You just won't give an inch on the old space discoveries there, will you?
Got a question and a thought for you there, Rosemary. If that camera can see to the beginning of time, of course, it begs the question, what was there before it?
Ah, yes, indeed. That's something to ponder as you leave work this morning.
Now, you get Miles O'Brien on that one.
Well, we try to.
That'll put paid to his model.
Telescope. Well, the set, Jim, it's getting a little dark.
Very good.
pretty good.
Okay, Jim, rolling starboard.
Pause when you're out, let me double check.
So, Mike, I moved the urn back a little bit so they get plenty of room.
Thank you, Nancy.
Yeah, I see a good tether config.
Okay, Rick, I'm headed up to the sidebar, is that correct?
Mike, you're going to translate to the orbiter's starboard sill. Open cushion and attach your safety tether to the aft. In this case today, we're going to go with try the forward slider.
The Space Telescope Operations Control Center engineers at the Goddard Space Flight Center in the process of powering down the faint object camera for the final time in its lifetime. In preparation for the opening of the aft shroud doors, you see Jim Newman affixed at the end of the shuttle's robot arm. Once the aft shroud doors are open, he will then begin the process of unbolting the faint object camera from its stanchion. It basically sits on rails, but there are a number of latches and bolts that hold that camera securely in place in the compartment in the aft shroud.
And people will go over that sort of pitch forward place over on.
That was a shot from the Hellman-mounted camera on Mike Massimino as he begins a work to retrieve an electrical harness that will be installed in the aft shroud of the Hubble Space Telescope associated with tomorrow's installation of a cryo-cooling device for the near-infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer. Now back to the Hellman-mounted view from Jim Newman as he uses a pistol grip tool to begin to unloose the latches and bolts holding the aft shroud doors together, containing the COSTAR corrective optics instrument and the faint object camera.
Four of them. Okay,
three. Four. That's fine. Just gentle pressure is fine.
So 54 minutes into this morning's spacewalk, the aft shroud doors are open on the Hubble Space Telescope to the compartment housing the faint object camera, and next to it the corrective optics package called COSTAR, which provided basically the contact lenses that corrected the vision for the original instruments on Hubble because of the spherical aberration to the telescope's primary mirror. Jim Newman at the end of the robot arm will be ready to begin sliding the faint object camera out of its compartment.
And Mike, some notes for you. Bottom of the FOC connector panel is a sharp edge, and to please minimize as possible boots in the aft shroud. Copy, Rick.
Jim Newman now changing out sockets for the end of his pistol grip tool on the workstation that he has available to him as he is affixed at the end of the shuttle's robot arm. This view from Newman's Hellman-mounted camera, 1 hour, 24 minutes into this morning's spacewalk.
thank you.
And just ahead on World News, astronauts venture back out in space with a mission to help the Hubble telescope see even deeper into the cosmos.
Tethered to the payload bay and to the Hubble Space Telescope, Mike Massimino now begins.
Astronauts have ventured outside the Space Shuttle Columbia to put an advanced camera on the Hubble telescope. It's the crew's fourth spacewalk, and space correspondent Miles O'Brien joins us to tell us more about it. Miles, so this one isn't going to be as hairy, presumably, as the last one.
No, the main event was the one 24 hours ago. That was when Hubble actually shut down for the first time in 12 years. A lot of people biting their nails, holding their breath during the course of that one. And it went off without a hitch. Hubble has a new heart, and its heart is beating. Its power system has been upgraded significantly during those first three spacewalks. Now the astronauts are getting down to the business of improving its scientific capability. Let me just show you where they are, because we're about to see some close-up pictures, and it's difficult to understand exactly where they are. They've opened a door here, which is about the size of a telephone booth door, and they're going to be removing an instrument here called the Faint Object Camera, which is the last of the original instruments of the Hubble, launched in 1990. It will be replaced by something called the Advanced Camera for Surveys, which, in round numbers, is about 10 times more powerful than anything that's been on Hubble in the past. It raises the possibility of some interesting discoveries. Let's look at some live pictures coming down now from the Space Shuttle Columbia as it travels above us, 580 kilometers in altitude, about 28,000 kilometers per hour. You're looking at the hands of spacewalker Jim Newman as he goes through the process, and it's admittedly, it's difficult to kind of understand where you are. Suffice to say, you're inside the Hubble right now, and you're looking at a piece of the faint object camera, that camera which is going to be coming out. This is some of the handholds that they're going to be placing on it to make it easier to pull it out. Once again, these are all kind of telephone booth size objects, which on the ground would be very difficult for one person to handle, but of course in the weightlessness of space is less of a problem. A lot of mass, so you have to make sure you don't move too quickly, because once things get going in space, it's hard to stop them if you go back to your high school physics. This process should take about 3 hours, or about half the 6 hour spacewalk, and the tail end of it, they'll do some preparation work for the next portion of the spacewalking, the spacewalk number 5, which will get a infrared camera back up and running. Let's tell you a little bit about this advanced camera for surveys. It's a $75 million camera, and if we take a look at some of the pictures we have of it, first of all, this once again will give you a sense of what they're doing and where they are. As I told you, they're in these doors here, the object. The advanced camera for surveys is in a little box, gets put in. The faint object camera goes back in the box, which is, after it's removed, goes back in the box that the advanced camera is put in. And the spacewalk at the end of the 15-meter robotic arm, this device here, will actually slide it in. It's got some guides that bring it in. Hubble was designed for this kind of upgrade. That's the advanced camera for surveys. And it is a $75 million camera that will look from ultraviolet all the way past infrared. In other words, all the spectra. And will provide the capability of generating tremendous images. Take as example the previous workhorse for Hubble, the wide field and planetary camera, captured this image here. And this image took 10 days to capture, aiming generally at the Big Dipper, to a point of sky that seemed, at least to the eyes of astronomer, to be fairly vacant. They turned this camera on for 10 days and came up with this deep field observation, which proved that even in places where it seems to be dark, look what you find. Thousands of galaxies, all sorts of galaxies. It raises all kinds of questions about the possibility of life elsewhere. And just statistically speaking, when you look at a dark piece of the sky and come up with those images, you have to wonder what's out there. Now, this new camera will be able to do a similar image. Instead of taking 10 days of Hubble time, can do it in 3 days and has better resolution. So it's quite possible that the advanced camera for surveys will take us back in time, if you will, to more distant galaxies, and thus galaxies right after they were formed, after the Big Bang, at least cosmologically speaking, right after, maybe 100 million years.
Fascinating possibilities. Miles O'Brien keeping us informed and updated. Obviously, the CNN prop budget has been exhausted for another year.
Yes, it is.
Right, let's get a check of the weather down here on Earth. Now, here's Jenny Harris.
Caught up nice and straight. Looking perfect. I want the really slow rates going into the telescope, and these are slow enough for this maneuver, no problem.
Jim Newman now lifting the brand new advanced camera for surveys out of its enclosure in the cargo bay of the shuttle Columbia, carefully sliding it out of its protective box, ready to install it in the Hubble Space Telescope to replace the faint object camera, which is temporarily stowed on a mounting bracket on the side of Columbia's cargo bay.
Maybe just yard a little bit to your left.
Agree.
Then
you got a little bit of roll.
Out of a left gym and roll and
yeah, roll towards the port side.
So what axis are you using?
We're using orbiter axis and your body axis.
Yeah, I'm using orbiter coordinates. So tell me what you want me to do with it.
Yeah,
I
want to
roll.
Telescope has a brand new scientific instrument, the advanced camera for surveys, having been successfully installed and latched in place. One final look-see by Mike Massimino inside the aft shroud of the telescope. This view from the helmet-mounted camera on Jim Newman.
October 1st, right? Exactly.
Newman's still at the end of the shuttle's robot arm.
If you feel you need Jim, please have him hold on to you and maneuver you as needed. Okay, I think I'll wait. What's my next then, John?
SOC is coming up.
Can I see that? Nance, he'll maneuver you.
Jim Newman at the end of the shuttle's robot arm now beginning to move the faint object camera into the proper location for its stowage and its cargo carrier in the cargo bay of Columbia. The advanced camera for surveys has been successfully installed and latched in place, awaiting its aliveness test, its health check, from the engineers of the Goddard Space Flight Center's Space Telescope Operations Control Center.
NASA officials are reporting good progress on the latest spacewalk by astronauts from the space shuttle Columbia. Their task, adding a new camera to the orbiting Hubble Observatory. Space correspondent Miles O'Brien joins us with the latest details. The spacewalk's still underway.
Yes, Shihab, before we get to live pictures in space, I just want to show you where they've been working. There's a thing called the aft shroud door, which is located here at the base of the telescope. This whole equipment bay down here is designed for the whole express purpose of changing things out in a modular fashion. And that's exactly what's going on. They pulled out an old box, popped in a new one. Fairly straightforward procedure, and so far it's gone well in space. Take a look at these live pictures now as the space shuttle approaches the landmass of Australia, hurtling around the planet at 28,000 kilometers per hour. Hard to tell that, of course, from these images. These pictures are shot from the crew compartment looking back toward the Hubble. There's the Hubble there. And this box is the last of the original instruments from Hubble, some 12 years old now. It's called the Faint Object Camera. It is the box that has been taken out to make way for this new camera right behind there. That's the Advanced Camera for Surveys. Now, the Faint Object Camera will go back in the box that the new camera came in. It's Jim Newman at the end of the 15-foot robotic arm, slowly maneuvering that down. His spacewalking colleague, Mike Massimino, is down there, tethered but not attached to the arm, as you can see from these pictures. Now, those eventually, once they get all buttoned up there and they get the cables all connected, they'll shut these doors, which have been problematic in the past. Hopefully, they'll have no problems getting them shut. They warp somewhat when they get opened. They're very thin, and the temperature differences are so extreme in space, every 45 minutes or so, that it can cause some warping. Now, let's take a look at some of the other images that came down throughout the course of the spacewalk, which is now 3.5 hours old, just about the midway point. There you can see them working before they got that new camera out. They were working to get it ready. It was carried up in that box. There's some close-up shots from one of the helmet cams, as they call it, as that Advanced Camera for Surveys, $75 million camera, was taken care of and put in place and attached to the Hubble Space Telescope. Now, what will the Advanced Camera for Surveys do? Well, astronomers are very hopeful. It will take them literally to places they have never been before. And as we look at some of the images from the previous workhorse on Hubble, the Wide Field and Planetary Camera, this is Mars, an unprecedented type of image in the sense that it gave them a global look at the weather patterns on Mars and a sense of how these poles are formed and how they shrink and expand depending on the seasonal shifts on Mars. In addition to that, they've gone to the farthest reaches of the universe with that faint object, or the deep field image, which I told you about a little bit earlier. Images that were taken in supposedly dark spots of the sky right about here, which generated all kinds of previously unseen galaxies. Galaxies that were formed just after the formation of the universe as we know it, the Big Bang. So this is pretty heady, profound stuff. The Advanced Camera for Surveys can push the envelope even farther, it is hoped, by these astronomers as we look at that deep field image. So far so good on this procedure that puts Hubble in good stead for its next 8 years of scientific operation, has an upgraded electrical system on the previous three spacewalks, and now has a new set of eyes that are going to resuscitate an infrared device on the next spacewalk coming up about 24 hours from now. They sort of make it look easy, don't they, Shihab?
Yeah, well, but you say that we'll be able to see sort of pictures from just of the edge of the Big Bang, but not the Big Bang itself.
The Big Bang itself will remain inscrutable to us. There's no way to get a picture of it because in the earliest stages, just subsequent to the Big Bang, there was such a dense piece of matter there that no light can escape.
All right, Mars, we have to leave it there, but thanks a lot for updating us. And the headlines are next here on CNN. Stay with us.
And Jim, just information only, the right side, as you look at it, of the FOC is about 18 inches from the A-type door.
Okay. Yeah, we want it. Guide real nicely back here.
Okay, I see we've got the clearance on the boot plate too.
I agree. Got a left hand on the GSD attachment here, John.
Copy. It's a good place.
I see it coming in nice and straight.
Might keep an eye out for the B ready.
Okay, I see lights still on.
Thank you.
Jim Newman working at the very rear of Columbia's cargo bay. You're looking at the view from the helmet-mounted camera on Mike Massimino as he has maneuvered down towards Newman to help retrieve the electronic support module from the cargo carrier at the very rear of the cargo bay. That module then will be brought back up to the aft shroud of the telescope and installed right in front of the Advanced Camera for Surveys again.
Scooter, come up too.
you up in a minute.
Mike Massimino at the end of the shuttle's robot arm being transported by robot arm operator Nancy Curry back to the aft shroud of the Hubble Space Telescope with a firm grasp on the electronic support module. This is the component that will be installed in front of the newly installed advanced camera for surveys in the aft shroud. You see the open doors there. It will be installed and latched in place. It then will be connected with an electrical harness that had been supplying power to the corrective optics package just next to the advanced camera for surveys, the COSTAR instrument that was first launched on the STS-61 mission in December of 1993 to correct the blurred vision caused by the spherical aberration in Hubble's primary mirror. The electronics box are being held by Massimino in this view from the elbow camera of the shuttle's robot arm will supply the power to the cryo-cooling device and the radiator for the NICMOS instrument in the repair work that John Grunsfeld and Rick Linehan will undertake tomorrow in the fifth and final spacewalk of this mission.
Okay, Scooter, I think we need to go into the telescope about one more foot.
Copy.
And probably to my right about 1 foot.
Tim, I got you the handrail latch clear.
Okay, thank you.
Jim Newman is at the very lip of the aft shroud of the Hubble Space Telescope on the lower left-hand side of your screen. This view from the helmet-mounted camera on Mike Massimino.
Up a little, Mike.
Slowly up a little. Okay. See the latch over here you got to get by? Take a little to your right there. Slow that. Carefully, slowly bring it down. Very nice. Coming in. How's that?
This view from the helmet cam of Mike Massimino as he continues putting those connectors on the new electronic support module.
I'm Houston, good to go.
Excellent. Jim, nice job.
And the lead.
Thanks, Jim. It's been a pleasure.
Enjoyed it, Mike. Really enjoyed walking with you.
It was
okay,
really.
Mike, you're heading in.
It was quite a thrill.
Got a lot of good work done.
You guys had a fantastic day. You got everything done, and you got that ACS in on the first try.
You did a great job with that alignment, Ed. We really appreciate that.
Seemed to work real well.
A lot of people got us ready. Mitch Johnson and Hank and Jeff Field and all those guys did a great job.
I'm sure they're all watching and listening. Okay, Mike, you're going to go in. Once you're in and comfortable, you'll attach your spare waist tether on your right side of the airlock.
Houston, with that long day for both you and a lot of the folks down here in the control center, we'll hand over to Orbit 2. Tony and Steve will take you the rest of the way. Great work today. I know you guys worked long and hard, and the days are cumulatively adding up, but it doesn't show in the big sense here. So good work, and we'll catch you tomorrow.
Hey, Mario, please pass along to everybody in the control center that we're all in this together, and we appreciate all the long days you've been putting in at the odd hours. We're all sleep-shifted, but you still have families and everything to go home to. So we appreciate it. The team is doing a great job staying in sync. We appreciate everything that you did for us today, talking about options, and I think we all converged on doing the right thing, and I'm glad that we've gotten all the tasks done that we have so far, and we're looking forward to a successful EVA-5. So Thanks again, and we'll keep pushing and get there tomorrow.
Thanks for the word, Scooter. We'll see you tomorrow.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to today's mission status briefing, updating on the progress of Columbia's voyage to the Hubble Space Telescope. The fourth spacewalk is behind us now, and here to talk about that is Brian Austin, who is the lead flight director for STS-109. Sitting to my right, to his right, is Dana Weigel. She is the lead spacewalk officer or extravehicular activity officer for this mission. Next to her, once again, Preston Birch, the Hubble program manager from the Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. And new to the panel today is Garth Illingworth. He is the deputy principal investigator for the Advanced Camera for Surveys from the University of California at Santa Cruz. We'll have brief comments from all four, and then we'll throw it open for questions. And I'll turn it over to Brian.
Thanks, Kyle. Today was a very successful day. We completed everything we set out to do today. It took a little longer. It took about an hour longer than our pre-flight plan. Today's EVA duration was 7 hours and 30 minutes. I think what you've seen in the first two EVAs, in the first three EVAs for that matter, each of the days we've had a little hurdle that we've jumped over, and it's impacted us on some time. But back out some of the failures that we've had and had to tackle, the first three EVAs have actually run ahead of our pre-flight plans by a decent amount, 30 minutes and sometimes even more than that. And what you saw today, we really didn't have that much in the way of failures. In fact, really inconsequential in terms of the failures, and it just ran a little long. And that's all tied up in what we kind of expect in terms of the EVAs as part of our timeline and certainty. We know going into these, the best we can do is gauge how they run in our NBL and our training part of the preparations for the mission. And we know we can expect things to run ahead at times and also to run behind. So really what you've seen today is just an artifact of that running a little longer. I think there's also a little bit more caution maybe put to today and being very careful in the aft shroud and with the instrument. But all in all, it was really a good day and really happy that we got things taken care of that we needed to today, and it really sets us on our pace and our plan for our last planned EVA tomorrow. We're putting the crew to bed a little later, just pretty much just as a fact that by the time they come in, it's really pretty much a straight course to how long it takes them to get the suits put away and get to bed. We expect them to probably get to bed about 3 p.m. tonight or this afternoon in local time. Wake up at this point, we're looking at about 10 p.m., give them about a 7-hour sleep. But again, that's just based on when they really finally go off to bed. And then going out to EVA 5, delaying that just a little bit, going out the door around 2:30 in the morning. But again, planning for a nominal EVA 5 at this time. We don't see any leans against the day or the end of mission and threats to any additional EVA, so we're really looking good and set up well for our last day out. And I'll let Dana kind of give you a little more details on some of the different parts of the day today.
Well, both suits performed very well today. We did have a few minor problems that caused the EVA to be delayed a little bit. One of the things that we spent time on was routing of a harness in the aft shroud. Harnesses tend to take on a certain shape or retain a certain memory, and that can be caused by the coiling of a harness, for example, in its launch position, and also by thermal conditions. We do expect that, and that's something that you sort of just have to deal with real time and figure out how to get the harness routed and get it laid out properly. But overall, we completed everything that was in the plan for today. And we're doing tomorrow's EVA per the pre-flight plan, and I'm looking forward to the successful execution of another EVA.
Okay, well, today was certainly a great day for astronomy with the installation of the Advanced Camera for Surveys. The astronauts servicing Hubble, as Brian mentioned, did everything that we had hoped that they would do. They first removed the faint object camera, and I think it's worth noting that this is the last of Hubble's original science instruments. This instrument was provided to us by the European Space Agency as part of the partnership that we have with them on the Hubble program. The faint object camera will be returned to the European Space Agency after the servicing mission, along with the two solar array wings from Solar Array 2 that were removed as well. Those were built by them. ESA has been our partner from the inception, and they also provided some significant hardware for the current mission, with the solar array drives that are part of solar array number 3. The ACS, or advanced camera, was successfully installed, and following that we had a good aliveness test on it. We're in the process of doing the functional test on it, and it will be several more hours before we complete that, but everything's looking extremely good with that. In addition, the electronic support module, which is part of the NICMOS cooling system, was installed, and we completed the aliveness test and the functional test on that as well. So all in all, it was a very good day, and we're really looking forward to tomorrow and winding up a successful servicing mission. And I think Arthur Illingworth is going to tell you more about the advanced camera and some of the great science.
Okay, thanks, Preston. Well, it's been spectacular the last few days sitting and watching this mission and what's being done to the telescope, and what will bring it to forefront instruments still and again for the future. And it's been fascinating to see this almost like a tune-up occurring on a hot automobile. And for the last few days, the first 3 days of the mission, the tune-up progressed extremely well, and we're looking for tonight the possible recovery of a major instrument that was put up a couple of missions ago. But last night, I think what the crew did was put the turbocharger on this telescope. The advanced camera went on. The advanced camera is going to add 10 times the capability to Hubble. And so here we have a telescope that is now incredibly faster, ready to move for the future. And as Preston mentioned, we have the advanced camera, very large telephone booth-sized instrument, and the astronauts did a fabulous job of putting that in. And this morning, ACS phoned home and told us it was okay and raring to go on getting checked out and then checking out the universe. And it's fascinating to see what we can now do with a capability like the advanced camera. There's remarkable gains in technology have gone into an instrument like this, almost like the PC revolution. This camera makes Hubble 10 times better for roughly half the cost of the original instruments, and reflects the dedication and capability of the team that got a Space Flight Center and the lead contractor for this Ball Aerospace. And it's actually three cameras in one. There's the largest camera is a wide field camera that covers twice the field of view of the previous cameras. It has twice the clarity and five times the sensitivity. And I just have a little chart here which can be used to demonstrate the capability of the advanced camera. And here on the lower right here is an image from the previous camera, the wide field camera, and what we expect to see with the advanced camera on Hubble. And you see the large gain in area, but you now also see that the images here are much brighter, sharper. And so these images are not only bigger, there's a larger area, there's more clarity, but there's incredibly deeper images in the same amount of time. And so just to give you an example of the science that we expect to pull out of this, one of the things that we will really hope to do is to start exploring in more detail the fringes of the dark ages in the universe. The universe is some 14 billion years old, and the first billion years were the time period in which galaxies like our Milky Way started to develop. And we've only now just started to probe into that. And Hubble, with the advanced camera, will allow us to make another step into this very challenging early period. Hubble, with its time machine-like capability with these cameras. And so, for those of us who are really looking forward to this, the scientific community who use Hubble and provide insight into the universe that everybody, that the people of the Earth benefit from, we owe an incredible debt of gratitude to the very professional folks at NASA who have done a wonderful job, the folks in the companies who together have worked miracles to bring about a telescope like Hubble, and broadly to the American people who have made all this possible. Thank you.
Thanks, Garth. We've got a limited time for questions because we have another press conference from KSC following this, so we'll try to get through this as quickly as we can. We'll start with Mark.
Thanks. Mark Caro from the Houston Chronicle, and my question's for Dr. Illingworth. Could you sort of explain how far back the telescope, or what distance the telescope has looked back, and with this improvement of the new camera, Will it take you back further than that, or will it just clarify and be more sensitive to the faintest objects you've already seen in that same area?
I think we'll go back further. It will clearly clarify and allow us to understand in more detail the objects that we've seen out to looking back 10, 11, 12 billion years. But as I mentioned, this Dark Ages, the period where we don't really know what has happened with the very first galaxies as they're starting to come together, occurs around about 12 and a half billion years. And the Advanced Camera and Hubble together will allow us to probe into that, not as far as we ultimately will need, but allow us to make the first tentative steps into this dark region.
Anything else, Mark?
Oh, thanks. Yes, my second question is for Preston Birch. The activity tomorrow of installing the cooler, could you sort of explain whether this instrument is sort of a one-of-a-kind? Is this sort of a prototype instrument? I'm trying to kind of get at the experimental nature of this. And what was sort of the long pole in the tent in coming up with this feature?
Okay. Yes, it's very much a one-off design. This will be the first time that I'm aware of that we've actually flown this type of a cooler in space. So it's very much pioneering type technology, and we had challenges on several fronts. One of them concerned the durability of the bearing material in it, and we had to go to a special coating that we call a diamond-like coating that's provided, I believe, by CERMET. And so that was one technical obstacle that needed to be overcome. Another one was contamination of the neon gas that's pumped through the cooling system. Any moisture in that messes the system up and basically makes it come to a stop. So we've had to be very careful with that. Another major challenge was the electrical power. We've had to try to keep the power down to the absolute minimum because we've had a lot of growth in the power requirements by the other science instruments that are coming along, like the Advanced Camera for Surveys and the next generation of instruments on servicing Mission 4. So there have been a lot of very unique things done. We flew the original prototype on STS-95, the John Glenn mission, and it worked, shuttle mission. It worked very well then, but we had to make a number of refinements to it in the areas that I indicated, as well as adding some redundancy to ensure its longevity on orbit.
Frank Mooring with Aviation Week. Could one of you telescope guys describe a little bit how you'll go about getting the camera ready to work, how long it will take, what you'll be doing, and when we could expect to see some images from it, and maybe even what those images would be? And if I could just go ahead and ask a question of Brian as well. I heard a call that there was not going to be a sixth EVA, that was off the table, I think they said. And is that so? I didn't quite understand what you just said about that.
Let me just take that first, because
sure.
It's probably rather short. A sixth EVA would only be as a contingency EVA, and we've set up from our ground rules or our flight rules that we would only really entertain that sixth EVA as necessary to complete our planned objectives, which were the EVAs 1 through 5. And as you can see, we're down to EVA 5 at this time. So right now, we're not forecasting anything to go wrong with EVA 5. So we have no liens against the other EVA days or any of the other tasks. So and we really said that to make that a point to the crew to make sure they understood what we knew, and as part of our discussions about the planning and the sleep and their concerns for protecting themselves and us all about a potential 6th EVA. There's other contingencies, I would guess, that could still come up, and they really don't really come into play until deploy day, and we just can't preempt those necessarily, and we expect that to go well, but right now there's nothing else in the way of tomorrow being our last EVA. And I'll let you speak some more to the plans for
easy as saw that. Yeah, okay. The Advanced Camera for Surveys, we expect to show to the public our initial, what we call our early release observations around the early May time frame. And the time between the end of the servicing mission and when those images are released will be devoted to fine-tuning the instrument. We have to go through a series of procedures to properly focus and align the three cameras that Garth mentioned that are internal to it, and to do a more thorough assessment of the performance characteristics of the detectors in there and so forth. So we want to take our time, and we do this in a very methodical fashion. And there will certainly be test images that we'll be taking during the course of doing that, but we don't feel that they're suitable for scientific research or demonstrating the full capability of the instrument. So.
Well, Frank, did that cover what you asked? I think that was a pretty complete answer for where we'll be going.
Unless you want to say where you're going to be looking first when you finally get it calibrated.
No, I think we'll leave that until you get to see the images. That'll be a surprise.
Okay, let's go to the Kennedy Space Center for questions there, please.
This is Phil Chen, Earth News, for Brian Austin. Good evening. Any concerns about the long days you've been having, both in orbit and on the ground? I assume that you've been up for about 16, 20 hours, because I have. And what are the issues involved in this, especially with the later days of the mission, constantly keeping everybody on short shifts and long times?
Well, I appreciate your endurance in keeping up with everything. Fortunately, I feel like I've gotten a little more sleep, but you're right. Our days have run long, primarily for our flight control team. A little bit had to do with just our initial team shift schedule. As we adjusted the EVA yesterday and then tomorrow a little bit to the right, our schedule has kind of stayed where it is, so it just results in a little bit longer day for a couple of us. But in terms of overall fatigue or mission impacts with the crew, I think we're okay. We've really made sure, as we really took this step function in the last day and moved the sleep over to really buy back the recovery to the crew, if you will. And I think we're still looking good. Of course, our surgeons talk to them every night, and they tell me only when we have an impact and are concerned about the mission. And so far, the crew's doing well. And our discussion we had with them this afternoon or this morning, my afternoon. After the EVA, it sounds like they're still in a good stride to get to bed on time. In fact, relative to the end of the EVA and how long it takes them to put up the cabin, they think they're going to actually try to get to bed a little early. So I think we're really showing that we're making the most of our days and still on schedule.
And because you're starting the EVA is much later than you'd originally planned, and because they've been lasting a lot longer than you've planned, you've been having a lot more orbits for the South Atlantic anomaly than you normally would have. Any concerns there as far as additional radiation exposure for the EVA guys while they're out there?
Well, I think you're stretching probably a little much. The EVAs haven't run that much longer in the first couple. In fact, today was really our longest one, and that's still pretty much within the box of, as I said, timeline uncertainty. The South Atlantic anomaly is always a concern. It's that long-term radiation impact to the crews. It's that we always make sure that we keep track of and protect. In fact, really today, as we stretched out, starting a little later in the day and then plus running a little long, we really just began to touch onto the edges of as our ground track came into that, and the surgeons looked at that and addressed that and determined that wasn't an impact today. And that was part of our discussion about whether to slip tomorrow any, and all of that added up to stay where we were, and it should not be a problem tomorrow. But all that factors into how we plan and replan and during the mission.
This is Steve Seislaw from Florida Today. My first question is for Preston, and that is, given the success you've had with these first four EVAs, if the cryo cooler doesn't work out, how much of a shadow would that cast on the mission?
I don't think it would cast much of a shadow at all. The main thing is to get the advanced camera for surveys in and get the Hubble electrical system upgraded, and we've done that. We've all recognized for some time that the NICMOS cooling system is a bit of a bonus. What we're doing is we're bringing a camera, an instrument back to life that originally had a known finite lifetime because of the design of it, the cryostat, as we've mentioned earlier, that had solid nitrogen in it. We always knew that was going to be depleted, and we got most of the good science out of it that we expected to do. So if we can bring it, resuscitate it with the NICMOS cooling system and get a few more years out of it, you know, we're just that much further ahead of the game. And if we don't, I don't think that we have to hold our heads down or anything like that.
Okay, thanks. And also, again for Preston, is the Is the ACS going to be superseded by the WIPIC 3, or is it still going to have a use even after you've done the next servicing mission?
It's not going to be superseded by the WIF 3. They'll work together in a complementary fashion.
Yes, Marcia Dunn, the Associated Press. For Brian, I'm not clear on why you have to push for a spacewalk tomorrow when you could just give the crew a rest and have it on Saturday.
Well, we've still got potential for things to go wrong that we want to have a safety net behind us, which would be another contingency EVA day. And at this point, we still have an EVA 5 to go. There's things that can go wrong in that day that could render the telescope in a very diminished capacity for deploy. If we have problems with the radiator and have to come in, we want to have that safety net behind us. But also on deploy day, we've got several items on that day that put the telescope at risk, an aperture door, the high gain antennas, which actually we're doing at the end of EVA 5, but several other items, and then the flight support system, lowering the BAPS ring down. So there's a number of items that we have as contingencies that we need to keep that contingency EVA out there on the backside of all of our leans against it, if you will, and we try very hard to keep it there. And obviously one time where it might come to play earlier is if it's truly necessary for us to take a pause and regroup if we've had a significant problem in one of the EVAs. Another potential could be like you're mentioning in terms of fatigue, but we're just not there at this point and we're still on the right course to save that in our hip pocket as a safety net and keep it on the other side of the release.
Thank you. And for Preston, when was the last observation made by the faint object camera and why was it decommissioned?
Oh, boy. I actually don't know, but the last observation was made, I believe, over a year ago. And as far as why it's been decommissioned, I think I'd have to defer to Garth on that.
The advanced camera also updates the capabilities of the faint object camera. The HRC is one of the three cameras that's in the advanced camera. Has very similar capabilities, but much more modern detectors. And so it's, again, much, much more sensitive than the faint object camera. And so it has a coronagraph too, which the faint object camera had, but unfortunately couldn't be used because of the spherical aberration. So the new camera replaces much of that capability and makes it much more powerful.
Could you also, Dr. Illingsworth, say, are you from Johns Hopkins? I don't think that was mentioned. And despite what you say, the camera has been working for the past year.
Yeah, I don't know what the observations were taken with the faint object camera. I'm from the University of California in Santa Cruz. So I work closely with the PI Hollenford, who is at Johns Hopkins University.
Todd Halverson of Space.com for Preston. At first glance, it looks like the two new solar arrays aren't exactly parallel, I guess. One looks a little bit off when I look at it. Is that something that's expected? Is that an understood thing? Do you have any idea why that might be?
Gosh, maybe I better go back and check the cameras there, but I thought everything was pretty well lined up. One thing is, you know, the cameras that are providing the views of the telescope are pretty close to the telescope, and so you do wind up getting a lot of distortion in terms of how the arrays appear to each other. And if they're slightly offset in their angle with respect to the telescope, you know, by the way that they can slew, that can also, you know, give you a strange view of it. But I'm not aware of any problem in that regard.
Okay, thanks. And for Dr. Illington, I think the question Marcia was trying to ask was why the FOC was turned off a year ago. In other words, what prompted the decision to stop doing observations with it as long as a year ago?
I don't know the exact reasons behind the decision, but much of the capability has been superseded by new modern detectors, so there's been less interest in the faint object camera in more recent years than there was in the early days. Just to add to that, the faint object camera is the last of the first generation instruments. So the technology dates from back in the 1980s, so it's clear that there'll be have been very substantial advances with NICMOS, with SIS, and with wide field camera too. And so you can imagine it's expected that the scientific interest would gravitate to the newest instruments.
Okay, I think that's all the questions we had at KSC, and I believe that Dave LaCrone Todd has an answer. We're going to put a microphone on him and let him give you a quick answer to that as well.
In its final years of operation, the faint object camera fell essentially into disuse. There was very little demand from the community for it because the capabilities of the wide field and planetary camera had basically overtaken that of the faint object camera. Actually, I would have said the technology was 70s technology. And so time just passed it by, and it did a wonderful job early in the mission on some very specific kinds of science. But after a while, you can't continue to support something like that if no one wants to use it. So we decided to decommission it.
Okay, and I believe, Todd, that Dana had a comment associated with the look of the solar array, so I'll let her answer that.
I think what you may have seen today is one of the arrays, the one that was forward in the bay, slewed by about 3 degrees. It was a little bit offset, and that's known to happen when there are EVA translation loads on the telescope. So when the crew is working on the telescope and loading it up, the array tends to slew a little bit. The way the harnesses are wound inside, they have a natural bit of tension, and as we move the telescope around, the array will tend to creep around a little bit. So that's just a normal occurrence while we're servicing the telescope.
Okay, that's all the time we have for the briefing. Just so everybody's aware, upcoming very shortly, the TDRS Tracking and Data Relay satellite launch atop an Atlas 2A rocket from the Kennedy Space Center is coming up, and the pre-launch news conference for that also is coming up. So stay tuned for that, and we'll be back tomorrow after the fifth and final planned spacewalk with our next mission status briefing, currently targeted for about 10 o'clock tomorrow morning Central Time, 11 Eastern. Of course, that's predicated on the completion of the spacewalk. So stay tuned, and we'll be back tomorrow. Thanks.
The fifth and final spacewalk to renovate the Hubble Space Telescope begins shortly. Astronauts try to revive an infrared camera that hasn't worked for 3 years, but everything else has worked on this mission. We're looking at live pictures there, just as the astronauts are about to step off into the cargo bay to start this spacewalk. Well, astronauts have replaced Hubble's power unit, camera and solar power arrays. The upgrades are designed to improve what has become the world's most spectacular window on the universe. There, Richard, just as you guessed, I got to squeeze in a space story, but without Miles O'Brien's space toys. And speaking of toys, I hope you get all the toys you desire on the weekend when you turn 40. Happy birthday. Had to squeeze that in.
Oh, yeah, Drake. Yeah, very kind of you, Rosemary. But you see, interesting, you're talking about the Hubble Space Telescope. You see, that's what happens when you get old. Bits start falling off and have to be repaired.
What are you suggesting?
Well, let's leave that on where it lies.
Let's move on.
You see an instant. Yeah, absolutely. Many thanks indeed. Many thanks indeed, by the way, to anybody who has very kindly sent me emails to point out that my fifth decade is almost upon me. Anthony and Joan says, remember, it's better to be over the hill than under it. I'm not sure I like the thought of that.
Columbia, that was Limp Bizkit and the Mission Impossible 2 movie theme song. It was for the entire crew. Well, after 4 spectacular days of impossibly difficult upgrades, Hubble is sporting a new improved set of solar rays, a new power system and camera system, and today you'll give it a high-tech cooler for its infrared camera. Keep up the great work and we'll do our best down here to help you.
telescope as Columbia passes over the Sahara Desert and the northern portion of Africa at an altitude of 360 statute miles. Commands have been sent by the Space Telescope Operations Control Center to begin the repositioning of the solar rays to provide access to the face of the telescope and the aft shroud that houses the near-infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer, which is the focus of attention today for John Grunsfeld and Rick Linehan as they install a cryo-cooling device and mount a radiator to the side of the observatory 13 feet high that will attempt to revive the operation of that infrared scientific instrument. On the far right side of your screen, you can see one of the fixed-head star trackers on the Hubble Space Telescope. Just above it, that white rectangular area, is the location of the Wide Field Planetary Camera, which has been in operation since December of 1993, installed on the first Hubble Space Telescope servicing mission.
Okay, I'm clear, John. Okay, you're good to open. Okay, I'll stop. Could you take a peek inside? I am right now, John. I've got my floods on inside, and I'm looking. It looks nice and clean. I don't see any floating debris at all.
Concur.
Pit pin. And Rick, you'll want to reinstall the pit pin. Yeah, that's coming up, Mike.
A good view of John Grunsfeld on the left as the free-floating astronaut tethered both to the telescope as well as to the payload bay, Rick Linehan riding the end of the robot arm. He will remain at the end of the arm through the installation of the experimental cryo cooler in the aft shroud of the telescope right in front of the NICMOS scientific instrument. We're about 3 minutes away from sailing into an orbital sunrise. Columbia currently over the southern Gulf Coast of the United States at an altitude of 360 statute miles.
And the still here, the upper handle looks like about maybe 6 inches or so. Looks like you have about 2 feet on your head. Yeah, the head looks good. Okay, let's stop here for a moment, Stuart,
right.
Please.
Yeah, I'm stopped, Tom. We're stopped.
Thank you.
Rick Linehan is in the process of removing the cryo vent line for the NICMOS instrument and temporarily stowing it in a bag.
And Mike, if I have a go, I can start turns.
Yeah, go ahead.
You're looking right into the Hubble Space Telescope. On the left side is the near-infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer. On the right, right in front of Rick Linehan at the front of the of his helmet is the Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph.
Okay. How about you, John? Fine.
John Grunsfeld now atop the manipulator foot restraint at the end of the shuttle's robot arm as he and Rick Linehan prepare to maneuver their way down to the Mule, the multi-use lightweight equipment carrier. Just behind Linehan, who's wearing the pure white suit on the right side, Grunsfeld, of course, at the end of the arm wearing the suit bearing the red stripes, where they will begin the work to open up the compartment housing the radiator for the NICMOS cryo cooler repair work this morning.
Okay, Scooter, we need to come down into the bay, please. 2 feet.
Copy that. I was just about to ask for a GCA.
Thanks, man. Okay, I'll stop, please. Okay, opening up the cover, Mike.
Copy, Rick.
And there she be.
Rick Linehan has opened up the cover to the enclosure in which the NICMOS cryo cooler is located in the second axial carrier, the centermost cargo carrying compartment in Columbia's cargo bay.
The reminder tether before the last bolt. Okay, how many bolts? Four, right?
Affirmative.
Okay. Scooter, if you could take me down in the bay, please, 6 inches.
Once Linehan retrieves the cryo cooler, he will open up two bypass valves that ultimately will allow the neon gas to flow into the NICMOS instrument.
Okay, I see a piece of debris floating out of the NCC. Scooter, bring me aft in the bay, please, 6 inches.
Coming.
Is it heading for the aft shroud?
This helmet-mounted camera view from Rick Linehan as he transports the Nick Moss cryo cooler up to the aft shroud of the telescope. John Grunsfeld working to close out several cargo areas around the second axial carrier, the cargo compartment in the center of the payload bay of Columbia.
Astronauts on Space Shuttle Columbia are conducting their fifth and final spacewalk as they try to give new life to the Hubble telescope. CNN space correspondent Miles O'Brien joins us now with more. Miles, tell us about today's mission.
Well, Jeff, this is all about resuscitating an instrument that sort of died on the vine there in January of 99. It's the Nick Moss camera. That's the near-infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer. A lot of stuff you don't necessarily need to know. The point is that it looks in the infrared spectrum, and in order to do that in space properly, it needs to be super cold, 100 degrees negative on the Celsius scale. The cooling system that was brought up with it didn't last very long. There was a leak in it. The nitrogen ice that was surrounding it leaked out, and it's been shut down since January of 99. Let's take a look at what the astronauts are doing to try to resuscitate it as we look at some live pictures. That right there is Nick Moss's new cooling system. That's a $21 million cooling system that uses neon gas. Neon gas is pumped through the system, out through a radiator, and all around to give the Nick Moss camera enough cooling capability to get back in business. Now, let's take a look at some animation while we look at this close-up. Hopefully the live pictures will come back. It's at the base of the Hubble Space Telescope, the opposite side of the telescope where they were working last night. There's the cryo cooler, as it is called, using neon gas, as we said. It gets attached to the base of the telescope, circulates around this neon gas, which is super cold, keeping Nick Moss cold enough to do its work. And in addition to that, as the heat is generated by the instrument, a radiator will be attached by the astronauts in the latter part of this spacewalk to shed heat on the exterior of the Hubble Space Telescope. So Hubble will actually look a little bit different. This radiator will be attached as well. That's all in the course of this 6.5-hour spacewalk, now about an hour and a half old. So Nick Moss is the chore of the day. Yesterday, the astronauts were able to put on the strongest camera to date on the Hubble, the advanced camera for surveys. Today, it's all about resuscitating a camera that isn't up and running just yet.
And so what are the benefits of this particular camera, the infrared Nick Moss camera?
Well, it's an important part of the spectrum. Let's take a look at some pictures, as a matter of fact. I brought a few with me to give you a sense of what Nick Moss sees. Now, this is a wide-field of planetary camera image. In other words, this is the visual spectrum of a nebula called Egg Nebula. And if you look beside it, or maybe the next image, you'll see the infrared version of that. Now, maybe go back one more time if you could, if you can go back and forth between those two. And what you can see is you're seeing many more stars in the infrared. That's the same spot of the sky, actually this little outline here. And you're seeing many more stars in this infrared portion of the spectrum. Infrared, after all, is sort of a heat measuring part of the spectrum. So stars that are in formation obviously would crop up. Now, this next one is the Egg Nebula. I had the wrong nebulas. Nebulas are essentially places where stars are dying. And if you look at this next image, you can see a side-by-side comparison of the Egg Nebula. This on the left, that is the visual spectrum, if you will. And this is the infrared spectrum. By the way, just to give you some perspective, from here to here, Job, is the distance of the Sun to Pluto times 200. So it's a big place that you're looking at, but nevertheless, you're seeing a lot more information about how the star is forming using that infrared spectrum.
Marvelous. The ever unnebulous Miles O'Brien updating us on the latest travails of the Hubble telescope. Thanks very much.
Why, thank you very much.
The bulkhead, John. Okay.
The left aft shroud door has been partially closed. That just protects the inside of the aft shroud during the time that this large radiator is being maneuvered into place. Linehan will retrieve the radiator and hand it off to John Grunsfeld at the end of the robot arm. This view from the helmet-mounted camera for John Grunsfeld now, as he is being lowered down to the cargo compartment to retrieve this radiator 13 feet high that will be mounted on handrails on the side of the Hubble Space Telescope to work in concert with the new cryocooling device, which has been installed in the aft shroud of the telescope just in front of the NICMOS instrument.
CNN space correspondent Miles O'Brien joins us with an update. How's the spacewalk going?
Shihab, it's looking good so far. About the midway point, 3 hours into this, the fifth and final spacewalk of the penultimate servicing mission to the Hubble Space Telescope, Shuttle Columbia, seven crew members, two of them outside at the moment. Let's take a look at some live pictures coming down from space, some 580 kilometers above us. You're looking at John Grunsfeld attached to the end of the 15-meter robot arm, which is attached to the Shuttle Columbia. He's getting a nice slow ride up as he and his spacewalking colleague, not seen here, look at that reflection, that's kind of a pretty shot there. Oh, we lost it. And his spacewalking colleague, Rick Linehan, are in the process now of attaching a radiator to the outside of the Hubble Space Telescope. That radiator, part of a new cooling system for an infrared camera, which went south in January of 99 after working for only 2 years. Its cooling system had a leak. The nitrogen ice that was packed in a thermos essentially no longer providing the cooling necessary for that infrared camera to work. So they're putting on a fancier $21 million cryo cooling system that uses neon gas to chill it down to negative 100 degrees centigrade. These are live pictures now coming from the helmet camera of Rick Linehan. You can see the wing of Columbia there as he's over the edge of the payload bay. This is the tethering system there, by the way. That's a guy wire which extends the length of the payload bay, and they just clasp onto it, much as a mountain climber might clasp onto pitons using carabiners and so forth. And there you see part of this radiator device that's going to be attached to the outside of the Hubble. So far, so good, Shihab, as they try to reinvigorate an instrument that offers astronomers crucial insights into a very important part of the spectrum, the infrared.
And perhaps you can give us more of an idea of why the infrared is a particularly important camera on the shuttle.
Well, I actually
on the Hubble, rather. Sorry.
Yeah, I've got a couple of images to give you an example. First of all, look at the Orion Nebula. The Orion Nebula is, that is in the wavelength that the human eye can see. It's a pretty picture, and if you look at that portion that is outlined in blue, and then which is right, you know, kind of here, and then match that to this upcoming image. That is upcoming image is a NICMOS image, near infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer image, if we can change to that one. And what it shows you is in that spot there's a lot more star formations than literally meet the naked eye. And because infrared detects heat signatures, a lot of these star formations, the birth of stars right here, and that's exactly what we're looking at. We're looking at essentially baby pictures of a galaxy, are more detectable using infrared. Let's look at the next image, the Egg Nebula, side by side. This over here is what you see with the naked eye, and that's an interesting picture. Don't you know, question that, but nevertheless, scientists can learn a lot more about this looking at it with a NICMOS image in the infrared. They know a lot about the temperature of things. What is blue is these hydrogen particles that are busy in the process of, in this case, the death of a star. So infrared, in other words, when you're an astronomer, you want to look in all manner of spectra, and infrared is one of the more important ones, especially as you get farther and farther out to the edge of the universe.
It's interesting that these advances in our viewing of the universe are occurring at a time when it would appear that U.S. lawmakers are less and less excited about space. They don't really want to fund the NASA project anymore, do they?
Well, you know, it's interesting. Space science is always an easy sell on Capitol Hill. Whenever you mention the Mars missions or Hubble and some of the tremendous advances that have come as a result of that, there's generally good support. Where NASA gets in trouble is on the space station. Which is a project that is hopelessly over budget, a difficult partnership with the Russians, difficult to even put a price tag on it, and until that program gets under control, Washington is going to be very flinty when it comes to budget time for NASA.
But the Hubble funding is safe.
Hubble funding has done all right. Space science is doing well so far. It's the space station that's in trouble.
Miles O'Brien, thank you very much.
Well, I get to see the APS, yes. T0 panel. Looks like a big surfboard, John.
Grunsfeld now beginning to engage the latches on one of the handrails at the top of the aft shroud of the telescope. You're looking right down the same view that John Grunsfeld has of this 13-foot-high radiator.
Seems to be the
During their training, the astronauts encountered a similar problem with fine-tuning the alignment of the latches on both the top and bottom handrails along the aft shroud of Hubble. Once the alignment is precise, those latches should engage properly.
What do you mean? Which angle? Lined up here. Can we come down a bit?
Yeah.
Tell me where you want to. I need you to come down, and I need you to check alignment while I do this. Can you see anything? Want me to let off the latch down here so it's a bit looser? No? Okay.
Nope. Okay, it's not perfectly straight, but I'm not sure how critical that is anymore.
You mean perfectly straight versus not on?
Yeah.
Let me check the alignment on this side. It looks like your side is over more towards the D2 doors than mine.
Grunsfeld and Linehan still working to precisely align the radiator so that all the latches engage.
I'm just saying that it's possible if we need to.
This radiator is being mounted in an area of the telescope just to the left of the left aft shroud door, behind which the NICMOS instrument is located, and so the radiator has to be positioned to provide enough clearance to be able to open that door in the future.
It might be wise to let me move it over to allow him to get a better lineup.
Stand by one, he's got it.
Okay, all the latches are latched. Now the question is the ground happy with that?
Okay, we're going to give them a camera maybe.
And as I said, I think I would get him. I just, we're talking.
Thank you. And I'm just talking to you. And Houston, we want to give you a camera. And our question, of course, is we have three latches aligned. It was a difficult task, and we'd like to know if alignment, perfect alignment is critical. I'd say it's very close, but not quite what we had hoped for.
Columbia, Houston, Jim, good alignment. No need to work it any further.
Sounds like the right answer to us. Thank you very much.
Hey, I see it off maybe from the tip to the bottom and, about 3 inches.
Copy that. And Rick, Houston says they're good with it, and so we are too.
Roger, I'm just giving you the numbers, Jim.
Appreciate it.
I'm ready for sure.
I copy you also, Jim.
Thank you.
This view of the new radiator, the NICMOS radiator, that will cool the NICMOS system. The near-infrared camera and multi-object spectrometer.
Grunsfeld on the right wearing the suit with the red stripes at the end of the robot arm. Rick Linehan to his left in the pure white suit. Now in place to begin the mating of all of the connectors on that conduit that was snaked through the bottom of the Hubble Space Telescope.
NASA astronauts stepped outside the shuttle Columbia on Friday to finish this mission's list of repairs and upgrades on the Hubble Space Telescope. Miles O'Brien is here with the details. Miles, a few hours into the latest and last spacewalk.
Yes, Shihab, we're about 3.5 hours in, and the astronauts just completed an important task right down in this region right here. They attached a radiator to the outside of the Hubble Space Telescope. That radiator will help cool an instrument inside this door here called the NICMOS. It's an infrared camera, near-infrared camera, and multi-object spectrometer. And it's in this area right here. This is an important piece of action because that particular device has been out of commission for the past 3 years. Let's take a quick look at live pictures from space, not the best pictures we've seen during this mission. You're looking at the image from John Grunsfeld's helmet-mounted camera, one of the spacewalkers, and you're looking at the cables that they're trying to connect to put this NICMOS cryo-cooling device together. Let's look at some of the better pictures, which came down just within the past few minutes and give you a better sense of what's been going on in space over these past 3.5 hours. There's Grunsfeld at the end of the 15-meter robot arm on the Space Shuttle Columbia. There you see the wing of Columbia over there. And there's Hubble, the base of Hubble there. And this is, once again, a helmet-mounted camera shot right at the very aft section of the payload bay of Columbia. Grunsfeld, once again, doing his chores, attached to the end of that arm, having your feet in place there, very important in space because you can't really get any purchase on any action with the bolts and so forth if you're not locked in, so to speak. Some pretty pictures as the shuttle goes over the Pacific Ocean there. This is the radiator I've been trying to tell you about. It's about 5 meters long, and it'll go to the outside of the Hubble, changing its look somewhat. The NICMOS device, it being an infrared device, needs to be very cold, negative 100 Celsius, in order for it to properly measure infrared emissions at the farthest reaches of the planet. Let's take a look at some animation, give you an idea of what exactly this is all about. It's a $21 million device. The cooling system that was attached to this infrared camera initially was essentially nitrogen ice packed in a thermos. It developed a leak, and very shortly thereafter, the device went out of business. This one is a little more sophisticated. Neon gas is pumped through it, very cold neon gas, through this cryo cooler. And in addition to pumping it through there, in order to further shed heat outside here, that radiator that you just saw is attached. It sheds heat as it goes out there, thus kind of completing a loop of cooling for the NICMOS camera. And astronomers are very excited about the prospects for all of this. So, five spacewalks now, four of them done and complete, this one on its way to completion. So far, they have made a very aggressive string of spacewalks look relatively easy. Of course, it isn't.
And as we look at these pictures, of course, space looking characteristically dark, but I don't know if I've misread a press release that I saw today, but the universe is, in fact, beige.
Yes, and I suppose Martha Stewart is happy to hear this, right? Although I guess she's into that celadon green or whatever she likes. But nevertheless, there were some scientists at the Johns Hopkins University were looking at the spectrum of the universe, and that's to say all the spectrum of the universe, and they sort of, as an afterthought, thought, well, you know, what if we put all of the items in the universe, all the stars and galaxies and planets, pop them in a box somewhere, what color would it be? And so they fed in all the wavelengths that they were able to detect, and they came up with what you see on the left of your screen there. Now, you and I probably would call that beige, but the scientists don't like that term. They see it as a form of white. Now, for people who have been following this fairly closely, the same group of scientists not long ago came out and said the universe, if all put into a box, would be turquoise. What happened? They didn't white balance. For anybody who's in our business, it's very important to pick white and come up with an agreed upon definition of white. There's some subjectivity involved there, depending on the color temperatures and so forth. So they picked what they determined is the ultimate of white, if you will, and came up with a beige universe. None of this seems very intuitive to me.
Very briefly, Miles, just talking to the producer of this show there, she couldn't quite see the point of all this, this discussion. I mean, what is the point?
Well, it's definitely angels dancing on the head of a pin kind of discussion. The point is, for these guys, it got them a lot of attention and probably will get them funding for their next study. But and it really was just sort of a, you know, an idle fancy for them. They did have a serious study where they were looking at some of the spectrum of the universe. This was the footnote, and this was the one, of course, that we in the media latched onto.
The pointless point. Okay,
yes.
Right. Marvelous. Miles O'Brien, thanks very much.
Go ahead, Nancy.
This view from the elbow camera on the shuttle's robotic arm. John Grunsfeld on the shuttle's robotic arm. Below him, Rick Linehan.
Thank you. And if you could look down and verify your clearance to Rick, or maybe we could change the orientation.
Yeah, we're getting pretty close to...
That's what I think.
Also needing to stop.
The arm is stopped.
Thank you.
Now 5 hours and 8 minutes into this fifth spacewalk of the mission.
The arm is right behind you.
The two spacewalkers have successfully installed a NICMOS cryo cooler and a radiator, all part of the cooling system. This experimental system designed to keep that infrared instrument very, very cold.
Okay, stand by, John. Okay, ready? And Mike, if you want to read us steps for completeness, you got it.
EVA officer reporting that the two spacewalkers only about 12 minutes behind on their timeline.
The note is to apply pressure to doors while engaging the latch bolts.
Yep.
Columbia, Houston, about a minute to a handover to Tedris Z. We're going to be blockage through the ZOE. We'll...
The illuminators are bright.
For some reason, I'm blinded, so I hope it's a good view.
Okay. We've, up here on Columbia on STS-109, we've just finished 5 days of spacewalking.
We've given Hubble a new power system that'll take it off into the next decade of discovery. We've given it new eyes to see deeper into the universe than it's ever been able to see before. And I think you'll see that people at the Space Telescope Science Institute, universities all around the world, amateur astronomers, young and old, will be able to enjoy the beauty and inspiration that these new pictures from Hubble will bring. I'm convinced that the next most incredible discovery from Hubble is one that's probably months, if not years, away. And the work that we've done up here on Columbia is just a small part of what has brought us to the point of being able to make those discoveries. Part of it, though, is the people, and it's people up here servicing spacecraft like Hubble and being able to make it better. That's really the incredible story. And although there's seven of us on orbit, there's a huge team on the ground at the Goddard Space Flight Center, Space Telescope Science Institute, Ball Aerospace, Wales, Orbital, Lockheed Martin, United Space Alliance. The list goes on and on with maybe thousands of people who've worked on this mission, tens of thousands, to get Columbia into the wonderful shape it's in for us to go to orbit. The other remarkable thing is that we're outside in a vacuum right now in our own little spaceship. I think Rick has a few words to say about the folks that have helped us get these spacesuits out here.
John, I was thinking about that all day. This is the first, over the third time now that I've been out in space. It amazes me that folks in Hamilton, Sunstrand can build a piece of apparatus or equipment like this that allows humans to come out into the most, the harshest environment imaginable and function and work almost as if we didn't have a suit on. After a while, working in the EMU, it almost becomes like a second skin, an exoskeleton. And it's just amazing what you can do here, and also the view. I just still can't believe that I'm here, and I've got to spend this time in space with six other just fantastic people. And there's no way we could have accomplished this mission without those people. Just an amazing crew. And just a wonderful experience. And I guess for a little kind of on a lighter note or comic relief here, this is a true story. My physics professor or my physics teacher in high school, he's listening. He used to tell me the only thing I'd ever be good at was taking up space. So I guess I made it big time. Thanks.
Well, HST is definitely an icon of science, but also the peaceful use of space. And to all the people above us on planet Earth, may there be peace on Earth. And thanks very much for helping us with an STS-109.
Hope to be back. Thank you.
We're heading in.
This is Mission Control Houston. That was John Grunsfeld on the right and Rick Linehan on the left. Making some.
We just want to echo the same thing. It's been a great mission so far, and there's more work ahead of us. I know.
I'll hand you the little key at the bottom.
Okay, I have it, John.
Can you have it?
All right.
Grunsfeld handing his tools off to Linehan, who will put them inside Columbia's airlock. Grunsfeld now coming off the shuttle's robotic arm.
Okay, release on my mark. 3, 2, 1, mark. We are released.
Open.
Okay, let's bring it down, Rick.
Okay, coming down.
Hello?
Yep, you got it, John?
Yep, I got it too.
Okay.
Manipulator foot restraint now released from the shuttle's robotic arm and will be stowed.
Rick Linehan at the end of the shuttle.
Astronauts from the U.S. space shuttle Columbia wrapped up the fifth and final spacewalk of their mission. The task at hand Friday, reviving an infrared camera on the Hubble telescope. The astronauts connected a prototype cooling system to the telescope's camera. The camera stopped working back in 1999 when a small leak made it run out of coolant. NASA will know in about a month whether the new cooling system solves the problem. That would allow Hubble to once again peer into the darkest regions of the universe. Well, now with a check of the global weather forecast, here's Femi. Okay, Femi?
Hello there, Colleen. There's a computer program which allows you to track the Hubble telescope. It moves pretty swiftly, five miles a second, so it takes about 96 minutes to get around the entire Earth. It's just about here right now. So as it, did you see it move there? That's amazing, wasn't it? So it moves across towards Africa. That's where I will start our international forecast there. I've been looking at some of my colleagues' work from the Joint Typhoon Warning Center. They've been putting together a forecast for Tropical Cyclone Harry. If you think it's huge, it pretty much is huge. We're expecting wind speeds up to 240 kilometers an hour. Any meteorologist will look at this and go, wow, look at the eyes, isn't that pretty spectacular? Unfortunately, it's very, very close to the northern section of Madagascar. Let's just point it out here on the computer. This is that northern section of Madagascar. The forecast is by Saturday, local time, this eye will be around about here in that northern section, so expecting a tremendous amount of rainfall. It will begin to slow down just a little bit as it begins to interact with the rough topography of Madagascar, and then the forecast is for it to turn further down towards the south.
Es war der 25. April 1990. Die US-Raumfähre Discovery setzt das Weltraumteleskop Hubble aus. Seitdem hat sich die Erforschung des Universums grundlegend verändert. Die Bilder, die Hubble aus den Tiefen des Weltalls liefert, sind einzigartig. Aber nach 12 Jahren sind die Renovierungsarbeiten an dem hochkomplizierten Teleskop notwendig geworden. Draußen im Orbit eine sehr riskante, schwierige Aufgabe. Jetzt sind die Arbeiten abgeschlossen. Insgesamt fünfmal mussten die Astronauten hinaus ins All. Mick Locher.
Es sieht aus wie in Zeitlupe. Aber keiner ist schneller als diese Außendienstler. Sie schrauben und montieren bei 28.000 Sachen. Der Akkuschrauber darf da auf keinen Fall verloren gehen. Vorsichtig hangeln sich die Männer in ihren Anzügen an dem scharfkantigen Teleskop entlang. Für 6 Stunden mussten sie raus ins tödliche Nichts. Ihr Blaumann ist weiß wegen der extremen Sonnenstrahlung. Im Licht sind es 120 Grad plus, im Schatten 100 Grad minus. 12 Millionen Euro kostet der Raumanzug mit Gasantrieb im Rucksack. Der ist lebenswichtig. Im Notfall fliegt man damit zurück zum Mutterschiff. ESA-Astronaut Thomas Reiter hier bei der Vorbereitung hatte beim Ausstieg aus der Raumstation Mir noch eine feste Nabelschnur zur Basis. Seine Erfahrung:
Man muss peinlichst genau darauf achten, dass man sich während dieser Arbeiten gut mit der Station verbunden hat, mit Sicherungsseilen. Denn würde man wegschweben und sei es nur mit 1 Millimeter pro Sekunde, es gäbe keinen Weg zurück.
Das ist noch nie passiert. Im Gegenteil. Der erste US-Aussteiger im All konnte von dem Ausblick gar nicht genug bekommen. Erst als die Luft knapp wurde, stieg er wieder ein. Die Astronauten trainieren ihren Ausstieg im Wasser. Das sichere Bewegen im 100 Kilo schweren Raumanzug ist nur im flüssigen Element möglich. Hier ist am ehesten das Gefühl der Leichtigkeit zu spüren wie später im All. Aber hier ist es mühselig. Alles funktioniert langsam, mühsam tasten sich die Raumfahrer in ihrem persönlichen Mini-Raumschiff vorwärts. Die im Englischen Außerfahrzeugmobilitätseinheit genannte Kluft ist die perfekteste Überlebenskleidung. Spezialfilter im Visier schützen vor der aggressiven Sonnenstrahlung. Wasser blubbert wohltemperiert durch die Unterwäsche. Das Einsteigen ist schon auf der Erde schwierig. Windeln, eine Trinkvorrichtung, Ventilatoren und Sprechfunk sind US-Standard. Den Menschen schützen 13 Schichten Stoff im offenen Weltraum. Darunter Nylon, Gore-Tex und das Splitterwestenmaterial Kevlar. Weltraummüll und scharfe Kanten dürfen den Anzug nicht aufreißen, sonst droht der Tod. In 15 Sekunden wäre man ohnmächtig, das Blut würde kochen. Zur Berufskleidung gehören ferner doppelstarke Scheinwerfer, eine Helmfunkkamera und besonders griffige Handschuhe für die knifflige Feinarbeit. Alles kein Luxus. Die Mechaniker verlieren oft mehrere Pfunde bei der gefährlichen Schwerstarbeit. Immerhin Kein anderer Job bietet dabei diese Aussicht mit Sonnenaufgängen alle 1,5 Stunden.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's been a busy day, a busy week. The fifth spacewalk is complete in servicing and upgrading the Hubble Space Telescope. And here to talk about it, our distinguished panel once again, is Brian Austin, who's the lead flight director for STS-109, Dana Weigel, who's the lead EVA officer, extravehicular activity officer for STS-109, Preston Birch, once again, the Hubble program manager from the Goddard Space Flight Center, and joining the panel for the first time, fairly excited, I would bet, Ed Chang, who is the lead scientist for the NICMOS cooling system, also from the Goddard Space Flight Center. As usual, we'll hear from all four folks here, and then we'll throw it open for questions. I'll hand it over to Brian.
Thanks, Kyle. Well, if you haven't been following all the EVAs and the mission to date, you've missed a spectacular show. It's just been spectacular watching this crew go. The team that I've been fortunate enough to work with in the control center and the team at Goddard and just listen to everybody work through the day and get this day done and bring these EVAs to an extremely successful close and get ready to release the telescope and let it go back out there and find some new things. The EVA ran approximately 7 hours and 20 minutes, I believe was our stop time. Everything went really well. We had a little bit of extra work and thinking about the radiator as it gave us a little bit of trouble. I'm sure the folks over here can spend a little bit more time talking about that. But all in all, we think we're in great shape. Crew's going to go to bed this afternoon about 2 p.m., wake up tonight, 8 hours later at 10 p.m., and we're looking for our first deploy opportunity, 4:03 in the morning. And with that, Kyle, I think I'll turn over to Dana.
From EVA perspective, this has been the end of an incredible series of very challenging EVAs. The success is attributed to the crew and also to the excellent ground team, both at Goddard and at JSC. Folks spent years developing these EVAs and also developing EVA hardware. We usually do about 35 to 40 series of water tank runs just to get pieces of hardware right before the crew even starts training. And Goddard has a very mature and experienced set of EVA engineers that come down and help us out, get handrails in the right places in order to perfect the EVA hardware, and that certainly has paid off for this flight. I'm really excited to have been part of this team and to know that we've left the telescope with some phenomenal capabilities. I'll hand it to Preston to talk about the cooler.
Thank you, Dana. The best word that I can think of to describe this servicing mission 3B, is awesome. That's like in totally awesome, dude. The Hubble servicing missions, in my view, just seem to get better and better, and this was by far our best servicing mission yet to date. This mission was crammed full of tough, challenging work, and many people on this mission privately didn't think that we would be able to accomplish everything that we had set out in our plan. This mission required an incredible amount of dedication and hard work by a huge team of people at the Johnson Space Center, Kennedy Space Center, Goddard Space Flight Center, private industry, and academia. And I especially want to thank all of them, and I especially want to thank our 7 crew members on the Columbia who were just absolutely incredible in how they pulled this off. I think the main reason for these huge successes is that the Hubble program of exploring our universe excites and motivates and brings out the best in all of us, and I think all of us feel very privileged to be able to work on these extraordinary missions. The spirit of teamwork and personal commitment and excellence is just absolutely fantastic. Today on EVA Day 5, we once again accomplished everything that we planned to do. We got the NICMOS cooling system installed. The major components of that were the NICMOS cryo cooler and the radiator. And this brings the total number to date now of successful Hubble spacewalks to 18, which is spread over 4 missions. So I think we have a lot to be proud of. And now to tell you more about the NICMOS cooling system and a little bit more about what went on today with EVA Day 5, Dr. Ed Chang will fill you in on the details.
Thanks, Preston. Well, good morning. This is the sort of mission status briefing that every project scientist dreams of having.
So let me revel in it for a few minutes. On behalf of the NICMAS cooling system team, I'm happy to report this morning that last night the cooling system components were successfully installed, and this morning we successfully completed our aliveness and functional tests. I know that the scientific community is very excited about seeing NICMAS come back into service, and in particular I know that the principal investigator of NICMAS, Roger Thompson, is very anxious to have his instrument operational again. So we all look forward to that and to an instrument that will work in concert with ACS for many years to come. The concept of the cooler started after NICMAS was launched, and it's been a little bit of a long road and a tortuous road. And there are many people to thank, most all of the people that worked on the NICMAS team, the people that worked with us in the operations world, Kennedy and Johnson, and particularly the crew, in developing what has been a fairly challenging EVA task to install all the various subsystems that are required to get it to work. But we're looking forward to having a system that's fully functional on orbit and that will return excellent science that we expect of it. It's the miracle of servicing that makes this possible, and I think we've shown again that the ability to go up there and service a spacecraft has many benefits, and being able to conceive of a thing after a spacecraft has been launched, execute it, and make it happen is something that's truly a very marvelous tool to have. Let me talk a little bit about the timeline for the testing of the cooler, because it's not as straightforward as one might expect. The team certainly hasn't let down its guard yet, because we have a very exciting couple of months to follow. Because of the nature of the cooler and the way it works, it's not possible to just turn it on and see whether it works instantly and whether it works instantly with the NICMAS. There are just time delays involved in cooling it and making sure all the contaminants are out of the system. And so we don't actually expect to fill the cryocooler for another few days yet with the neon gas that is expected to carry the heat out of the NICMAS. And then we don't actually expect to run the cooler itself to start to cool down for another week or two. And this is so that the contaminants that are still there from the servicing and from the ash shroud have a chance to escape, so that these don't condense on the cold surfaces and affect the performance of the cooler. So in about 2 weeks or so, we'll be starting the cool down. The cool down itself is predicted to last about a week, with some fine tuning and so forth. There will be another week to fine tune the parameters of the cooling loops, etc. And it will take about a month before the instrument's actually on at the temperatures that we expect. After that, we'll be working on the NICMAS instrument to make sure the instrument is working well and to understand it again, since we haven't seen it working for a couple of years now. And after a few weeks of that, we'll be ready to take what we call the early release observations, which are the first science images coming out of NICMAS. And the net result is that you should expect to see, and we anticipate seeing, some results from the NICMAS in the early May timeframe. So with that, let me stop.
Okay. We'll start here as usual and then go to the Cape. Start with Mark.
Mark Caro from Houston Chronicle, and I'd just like to follow up on Dr. Chang's last remarks. Do you have any idea what you would like to use as a demonstration photo when you release something to demonstrate? Is there something that would really, you know, really illustrate what the telescope could do? And then I have a follow-up question.
Yes, we do have a process for planning what we call these early release observations, and they're done for every instrument, every scientific component that we put up on Hubble. We don't release those observations before because there are details related to scheduling and so forth, and when it happens, there may be one target, but then because of extenuating circumstances, another one has to be selected. And so there's a list of them that we can go down. And so I would advise you to wait patiently like we are for the observations to come out.
And I just wonder, is there any chance, do you have any hope that this technology may actually make the imager better than it was before when it was cooled with nitrogen? Is there that possibility that you could really see something even more powerful with the optics?
With anything as complicated as a science instrument, almost every aspect that goes into its design is a trade-off. You trade off one performance parameter for another. With the original NICMAS design, we used solid nitrogen in the design, which meant that it was to be operated at a temperature in the upper 50s of Kelvins.
This is driven less by the optimization of the detector performance than it is by the fact that you are using solid nitrogen and you don't want it all to evaporate away. You have to stay below what is called the triple point of solid nitrogen. The detector, as it turns out, and I think this is what you're driving at, actually operate better when they're warmer. But because of the design of the cryostat, it was actually operated colder than optimal. And so at a warmer temperature, we do anticipate that what we call the quantum efficiency of these devices, the sensitivity of light, will be somewhat higher than the quantum efficiency that we experienced before using the solid nitrogen. But then on the other hand, there is this thing that we call dark current, which is the amount of light that the detector just thinks it's seeing even though it's staring in darkness. And the dark current rises as a function of temperature. And so there will be a new trade-off as to where the temperature should be. One of the wonderful things about this cryocooler is that we have a control over what temperature we run at now. It's not a fixed temperature like in a solid cryogen system. And so as the part of the time that I was describing, the several weeks in optimizing the cooler and the instrument performance, part of this time will be spent finding the correct temperature to operate at to give us the best performance in the instrument.
Frank? Frank Mooring with Aviation Week. A couple of operations questions. I noticed that the crew was doing a lot of cleanup as they went along looking for debris. Could you discuss a little bit the potential impact of any debris that was left and also how well they did at the cleanup? And just to ask my other question, if you could, Brian, tell a little bit about what's going to happen tomorrow in terms of getting the telescope ready to deploy and then deploying it, and also if the crew would be ready to go out and help with that process if necessary.
Want to talk about the...
Yeah, I'll handle the shred. There was one piece of material that that got away from the crew today. It was a washer, a small washer about the size of a nickel or so, made out of Delron, and it floated out of the bag when the CPL evaporator was being deployed to be installed onto the cooler. This is part of the radiator and capillary pump loop system. And so that floated merrily off into the aft shroud, and the crew was not able to find it and recover it. We're not concerned particularly about that. And the reason why is because, number one, the washer is made of a non-conducting material, so it doesn't pose any shorting type hazard. Number two, the instruments are incredibly well sealed inside the aft shroud in terms of their interface with the focal plane structure and assembly in there. So we think that the likelihood of that washer floating out and getting in the way and interfering with the science instruments with the light coming in from the telescope is extremely remote. One engineer ventured to say one in a million because that engineer is sitting next to me. It's extremely well sealed, so we're not concerned about that particular object or anything else. If there were extremely small particles of dirt, which I'm not aware of, you know, that would potentially be more of a concern. But everything is very clean.
Anything else? Do you want me just to follow up?
Tomorrow's
in general our sequence of events. Tomorrow morning, it generally kicks off after the crew wakes up and gets out of their post-sleep activities. One of the leading activities relative to the telescope is the battery charge. We have want to get the batteries topped off, so we've dedicated a couple of orbits to battery charging. And once that's completed, Nancy will get with the arm and grapple the telescope. We'll unberth. We'll keep it up there again, do some more checkout, and the stock will have some extensive commanding as they get the system ready to go, and then get the aperture door open, obviously before we release, and then set them on their way. And we've got a couple of separation burns that we typically do after deployment. Later on in the day, we'll bring the BAPS or the stow it down in the FSS and prepare it for its end of mission and return home. In terms of contingencies that could go on tomorrow, in terms of EVAs as well, there's a couple of payload related contingencies that we still are protecting for. One and very important one is the aperture door, and then further on in the day could be if the FSS does not fully stow down and clear the envelope to close the payload bay doors, and both of those would require a subsequent EVA to go out and take care of those. Neither one of those are time critical that they have to happen tomorrow on the same day as deploy, so we would have the opportunity to put the telescope, in this case, if it saves the aperture door, we would put the telescope back down on the FSS and prepare ourselves to go back out more than likely on the day after that and clear the problem and deploy that same day. Definitely with the FSS, since it's so late in the day, that's something that would more than likely occur the next day.
Okay. Let's go get the Kennedy Space Center questions, and we'll wrap up here after that. Go ahead, KSC.
Hi, good morning. Peter King with CBS News Radio, and I've got two questions. First, for Preston, when will we know that everything works the way it's supposed to be? Will it be weeks? Will it be months?
Okay, well, I can tell you right now that everything that we have installed so far on this servicing mission in all 5 days has passed all of its aliveness tests and functional tests. And the functional tests test out those characteristics or capabilities of the various components that are deemed to be mission critical. So the latest thing that was installed today, the NICMOS cooling system, it has passed both parts of its functional test. As Dr. Cheng just described, it'll be some number of weeks before we know fully whether the cooler is totally doing its job with the NICMOS science instrument. But our best information right now tells us that everything that we installed functionally is working as designed and as we hoped it would. And as a matter of fact, in terms of the advanced camera for surveys, its level of performance after some additional testing overnight, it turns out that it is substantially exceeding its performance specifications. And I can tell you the principal investigator, Dr. Holland Ford, is ecstatic about that.
And for Brian, it's been a while since we've heard anything about the cooling loop on Columbia. How is it doing, and how long will the payload bay doors have to be closed on reentry day before it becomes a problem?
Well, it's not a player really in any of that, and you haven't heard much about it because everything's doing fine with that loop. It's continued to be stable at the level that it's been at since the first day of the mission, and it doesn't pose any additional constraints to us with respect to our abilities to keep the doors closed. That's generally related to how much of our water that we have available to cool the vehicle with the doors are closed. Normally the Freon loops help to dissipate that heat out through the payload bay doors and the panels. When the doors are closed, we have really lost all that efficiency, so to cool the orbiter we use much more of the water in the FES or the flash evaporator. And so the length of time the doors can stay closed is really just a function of how much water we have stored up that's generated from the fuel cell. So that really doesn't play at all with the Freon loop problem at all. So we have a typical several revs of generally deorbit opportunities each day that allows us to press through each day. So the Freon loop's fine, and it's not going to change anything for our deorbit and entry plans.
This is Steve Seisler from Florida today. My first question is for Preston, and that is how does this week match up, give us some perspective how this week matches up in the history of Hubble?
Gee, that's a tough one. It's I think it's the greatest, absolutely the greatest. I mean, the amount of work and effort that went into do the things that we had to do here, I mean, it's I think easily the equivalent of servicing mission one, as everybody probably recalls. That was extremely important for us to overcome spherical aberration, and I was part of that program at that time, and there were some challenges there, but I don't think in terms of the actual servicing work that had to be performed by the astronauts, this was far and away the most difficult, most challenging work. And there was a lot on the line with this mission in terms of changing out the power control unit. I mean, I'm turning Hubble off for the first time, there were lots of opportunities for mistakes, lots of opportunities for glitches to occur, and it was just absolutely flawless. And I can tell you this crew worked harder than any other crew that we've ever had, and the engineering team and the operations team has worked harder than any other team that I've seen on any previous mission, and that's what it took to pull off a great mission like we've had this week. So it's the best.
Thanks. And along those same lines, you replaced the power unit this time, and the faint object camera was the last original instrument to come out. How different is the telescope now than it was when it was first launched?
It's a far better machine than when it was first launched. I mean, it's the capabilities in terms of the science that it can produce. We've got a whole new generation of technology in there now, and some more exciting technology on the way in the next servicing mission that's coming up. But I think it would take an astronomer to better describe and convey a better sense of appreciation of what these new tools can do. But overall, the observatory, I believe, is far better than when it was launched.
Okay, and thank you. I have one last question for Dr. Chang, and that is, when the NICMOS was operating for those 2 years, what did you find then, and how did you use that to calibrate what you wanted out of your cooler?
Okay, I think you're referring to the performance of the instrument or its science program. Let me address the performance first, because I think that was the gist of the latter half of your question. When the NICMOS warmed up at the end of the cryogen, we took a series of data that allowed us to understand how the dark current and the quantum efficiency behaved as a function of temperature. So we had no control over bringing the temperature back down again, but as the cryogen ran out, the temperature slowly rose, and so we do have a map, if you will, as a function of temperature of how these parameters behave. And when we looked at the design of the cryocooler, we certainly consulted these maps to try to understand what the target temperatures were and where we wanted this to be for the final NICMOS configuration with the cooler. So that's how we have some feeling for what we hope will be the performance of the NICMOS after we bring it back with the cryocooler.
This is Marcia Dunn of the Associated Press with a couple of questions for Dr. Chang. You mentioned that your first results will be released in early May, but certainly in the weeks before that, you and other scientists will know if it's actually working. When do you think astronomers will know whether this worked?
Well, there will be a period even before the early release observations where we'll be doing calibrations on the instrument. And I think probably, if I were to guess, so that would be the period where we'd get our best feeling for how well the instrument was working. And so I would be talking about, say, the mid-April time frame.
Thank you very much. And I'm wondering, if there's anything that's not quite right, can you do anything from the ground to fix it?
It depends on what is not quite right. We do have certain things built into the cooler in anticipation of some uncertainties in the design and uncertainties in how the NICMOS will behave. But because the cooler is a very fast track and experimental system, it's not fully redundant by any means, and certainly not in the same sense that most Hubble instruments and hardware is redundant. And so there is a large phase space, if you will, of things that we can accommodate with the cooler, but it certainly depends on the nature of the problem. I remind you that this hardware has flown before, and it's flown with a simulator of the NICMOS during STS-95. And so the bulk of the hardware that's up there has been tested in flight on the shuttle in the 10 days of straight operation during that flight. And so we do have a sense that this cooler will be performing the way we expect.
Thank you. And for Preston, I'm wondering if you're surprised by the little things that have floated out of the various ash shrouds. I know yesterday one of the spacewalkers got pieces of paper on his gloves. Is this to be expected? Because I know it's supposed to be so clean inside of there.
Yeah, it was a little bit of a surprise. But on the other hand, there are an awful lot of piece parts and components, and the telescope is 12 years old. There was that one object that was sort of a black square-shaped thing that came off, and the washer that I mentioned earlier. But I would say overall, we've got nothing to complain about, and it does not pose a threat to the performance of the observatory or the safety of the observatory.
Steve Seisloff again from Florida Today. I just have a quick question for Dana, and that is, since you had the helmet cams this time working on this complex machinery, how much did that help you out?
It was a great help. in a lot of cases we could press on faster because the crew could just get in a certain position and give us a view and we could give them guidance. And of course we appreciated the great views we got from them as well.
Okay, that's all from Florida. We're back here for a couple of quick follow-ups. Mark?
Mark Harup, Houston Chronicle. Yeah, I guess I lost the trail on the plastic washer today. Did that come from inside the telescope? Did that come from somewhere else and float in?
It was introduced into the telescope by an object that we were bringing in there, the CPL evaporator, which was part of the cooling system. We had part of that in a protective sock, and when the sock came off, this piece floated out and rapidly got away from the astronauts, and they weren't able to grab it or do anything about it.
I just wondered, was this supposed to be on the cooler, or was it some sort of a kind of a fastener or holder that wasn't?
It's just a spacer, and it does not create a problem in terms of the performance of this particular object, the CPL evaporator or the cooler.
Frank, you have a final question? Let's get one last one real quick, and then we'll close.
For Brian, were you able to do the reboost yet, and how far did you go?
Let me see. That was not done yet. It's supposed to be done today. It'll raise us up. Apologize, I don't have the numbers exactly here. It's supposed to be done here in a couple of, I think in the next hour, next 30 minutes actually. It'll be about a little over 30 minute reboost time, and I believe raise the altitude about 3 miles?
3.5.
3.5 miles. So that's coming up momentarily.
Thank you. Oh, let's grab Mark for one last last one there. Sorry.
Mark Carruth, Houston Chronicle. This is for Brian. Does the deploy opportunity go orbit by orbit tomorrow, or is there kind of a hard down time where if you had a problem you'd have to wait a day or something like that?
Well, let me say, we definitely have two opportunities tomorrow that we're working toward. We have a window, just like a launch window, we have a deploy window that's about 20 minutes within each of those. Right now we're just working toward a prime and a backup opportunity. We can generally delay that a little bit orbit by orbit, but we will run into the end of the crew day and the activities that we still need to get done that day. But right now we're planning for a primary and a backup deploy one rev later.
Okay, that's all the time we have for the briefing. A couple of quick programming notes. Upcoming next is the video file, daily video file from NASA headquarters. And also there's other things going on in the launch business. There's an Atlas launch of the next tracking and data relay satellite coming up late this afternoon. So we'll enjoy that coverage beginning live at 4 p.m. today Eastern time, with the launch window opening at 4:39 Central, 5:39 Eastern time. And we'll be back tomorrow after Hubble deployment with our mission status briefing scheduled for 8 a.m. Central, 9 a.m. Eastern. So we'll thank you guys, and we'll head back to Mission Control and back to space. Thanks.
Houston, HST folks are happy. They've gotten everything they've needed. Excellent job for keeping us informed and keeping things well documented video-wise. You're the producer-director. Next video is your call.
Copy. We have the model to assist us in our view.
A good grapple of the Hubble Space Telescope confirmed. Nancy Curry working with Mike Massimino at the aft flight deck of Columbia. Massimino responsible for the grapple and the unberthing of the telescope. Nancy Curry will be responsible for the deployment of the telescope less than 3 hours from now.
Well, a few hours from now, the U.S. Space Shuttle Columbia is expected to release the Hubble telescope. The shuttle will then begin its journey home from space, and that's expected to take about 3 days before they reach Earth.
Robot arm operator Nancy Curry on the left, John Grunsfeld, the prime spacewalker on the right, and Dwayne Carey now floating into the field of view.
Payloads.
Yes, Digger.
John, excuse me.
Hey, Mario. Camera setup's complete and HST umbilical disconnect and power transfer pre-checks are complete. We're waiting on your go for dead face umbilical in step 3.
Roger that. We're working on it. Columbia Houston, copy. We're go for the maneuver. It should take about 30 minutes, and we have good TV for imagery through the rest of the West Pass.
Okay, Houston, roger that.
Commander Scott Altman now will begin a 30-minute maneuver to place Columbia in the proper orientation itself for the deployment of the telescope. Again, you're looking at the face of the telescope along the aft shroud of the observatory with the three fixed-head star trackers. Now in this view, another view from another one of the payload bay cameras showing the two high-gain antennas deployed in the correct orientation perpendicular to the body of the telescope. The 43.5-foot observatory refurbished and upgraded, ready for its deployment to fly free once again, just 1 hour and 2 minutes from now. This, again, will be a 30-minute maneuver by Commander Scott Altman at an altitude of 362 statute miles above the Earth. This maneuver designed to place Hubble in the correct orientation for its release. A good view of the 43.5-foot high observatory poised at the end of the shuttle's robot arm for deployment at 4:04 a.m. Central Time. Again, the three dark objects along the aft shroud, the two ovals and the one circle, those are the fixed-head star trackers on Hubble that provide navigational updates to Hubble's computer so it understands its position relative to the Earth. Right above it, the white rectangular slot is where the wide-field planetary camera is located.
Columbia Houston for the deploy.
Houston, Columbia, go ahead for the deploy.
Yeah, Scooter, big picture here for the moment. We're holding at aperture door open from our end, and we won't do that till we get into the release attitude, which is, we think, in approximately 20 minutes or so. Stock is busy commanding at the present time, and we're hoping to go for a release on time, but we think we might be challenged to meet the window open time due to the amount of commanding we have to do at this point.
Okay, Houston, we will stand by and not get too far ahead till you give us the go to proceed.
Mario Runco, the spacecraft communicator here in Mission Control, along with lead flight director Brian Austin, informing Commander Scott Altman that because the crew was very deliberate and took a little more time than had been expected in unberthing Hubble and maneuvering it to the deployment attitude, and because Columbia is currently being maneuvered to the correct orientation for the release of the telescope, which you now see in this downlink picture as the orbiter flies over Australia. Guidance, Navigation, and Control Officer reports that Columbia is in a good configuration for the deployment of the Hubble Space Telescope, now just 2 minutes away. Clocks on board Columbia now counting down less than a minute to the deployment. All of the orbiter's jet thrusters have been disabled to provide the most quiescent environment for the Hubble Space Telescope at the time of robot arm release, now just 40 seconds away. Standing by for the opening of the snares.
5 seconds.
Concur, Scooter.
Standing by for deployment. Deployment confirmed. The robot arm backing away from the Hubble Space Telescope. Applause in the Space Telescope Operations Control Center. The refurbished, more powerful Hubble Space Telescope flying free once again, ready to resume its voyage of discovery. And the first separation burn is now underway. Columbia departing the Hubble Space Telescope, not to be revisited for the next 2.5 years.
Columbia SEP 1 burn performed at 7 days, 22 hours, 43 minutes, and 6 seconds.
Copy, Digger.
Flight Dynamics Officer reports back to Lead Flight Director Brian Austin that the separation burn was perfect, right on time. The correct relative motion between the two vehicles, the Hubble Space Telescope free once again.
We have a beautiful view of Mr. Hubble, the telescope, over the Earth's horizon, ready to go and make new discoveries. And from the crew of STS-109, we bid Hubble well on its new journey with its new tools to explore the universe. Good luck, Mr. Hubble.
And we wish it well from down here as well, John. Thanks for the words. Columbia Houston, I think you'd be happy to know that HST has transitioned to normal mode.
Yes, that's great to know, Mario. Thank you.
That call indicating that all of Hubble's systems are now up and running under the guidance of the Space Telescope Operations Control Center at the Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland, now in full command of all of Hubble activity. So with Hubble flying free, once again under the control of the telescope engineers at Goddard, the shuttle portion of this mission with Hubble has now come to an end, and the shuttle astronauts can now turn their attention to the rest of their flight and a landing on Tuesday morning pre-dawn at the Kennedy Space Center.
Columbia Houston, we have a good view of Hubble from down here. Thanks for the downlink. You're right, it is an ooh-ah picture.
Bravo and Charlie, let's keep tracking.
Thanks.
Launched on April 24, 1990, almost 12 years in orbit, the Hubble Space Telescope set to resume scientific observations.
Go ahead, Nancy.
Sort of a photo frenzy on the flight deck, and I'm kind of been banished from my corner, so RMS power down will be delayed a bit until we lose out of Hubble.
Copy, photo frenzy. Scooter, Dana's on.
Okay, copy that. Dana, this is Scooter. Just wanted to talk to you for a minute.
Great, Scooter.
And Dana, hey, I just wanted to pass to you and Tomas, Christy, the whole team, but especially you three, how tremendously happy we are at the training we got, and just how that we couldn't have done it without you, how much we appreciate all your work.
You guys did an excellent job. You made us very proud. A lot of smiling faces here. All the HST folks have been sitting on the loops, expressing their thanks to everyone down here and especially to you guys up there.
And Dana, if you could pass on to Tomas, in particular from Mike and I, we'd like to say the Grasshopper on board has graduated.
Copy that, Jim.
With us today to discuss the events that transpired on orbit overnight aboard Columbia are Brian Austin, the STS-109 lead flight director, Phil Engeloff, the STS-109 mission director, Ken Ledbetter, the director of programs from the Office of Space Science at NASA headquarters, Preston Birch, the Hubble Space Telescope program manager from the Goddard Space Flight Center, and Dave LaCrone, the Hubble senior project scientist from Goddard. And we'll start with Brian.
Thanks, Rob. Well, we had an outstanding deploy of the telescope this morning, a little after 4 o'clock, down off the east coast of South America, if you're following along with us. Everything was smooth and quiet and a great close to an outstanding mission. Following the deploy, about a rev later, we conducted a perigee adjust burn, which will help us work toward our deorbit in a couple of days and bring in a couple of an opportunity for KSC, an additional one. We've lowered the BAPS, the berthing positioning system, the ring down, and prepared the whole system for entry. We're in a good configuration there. We'll be waking up the crew tomorrow, or tonight for most of you, 7:22 this evening. And tomorrow, their day again, as it phases into entry, we'll give them some off-duty time, and they'll begin with their cabin stow activities later on in the day. You know, we really left our mark on this on HST during this mission, and I think it's it will be visible in both the work that we've done and all the rewards that we'll see afterwards. The choreography, it's just been outstanding with the team on the ground, on the stock, the team here in Houston, at the Johnson, the Mission Control Center, as well as with the crew, both inside and out with the EV crew. From the rendezvous, the grapple days, throughout all of the EVAs, the deploy, in fact, all the way down to the perfect flyover that we were able to enjoy here in Houston, looking outside the control center with both the telescope and the orbiter just in tandem, it's outstanding. It seems like the folks from Goddard have been down here and working with us for a long time. A lot of the faces have been around for a long time. And in fact, I think maybe they've been here a little long because we're starting to hear them talk in sentences that include y'all and fixing to. So it may be time to send them back up home for a while and get a little dose of home cooking. I know they've been without that. I know they're ready to get back. I just want to say, though, it's really been a tremendous privilege to be a part of this mission and really been able to be a part of each of the previous missions, and this has truly been the icing on the cake.
Well, thanks. It's a real pleasure to be up here today under the circumstances that we have of having such a successful mission under our belts. This is a business in which we can never seem to come up with enough superlatives to describe the work that we've done, not just over the last few years with the work on the Hubble and the assembly of the space station, but every mission that we fly, we seem to come home and say, gee, this was the hardest one we've ever done, and this is as successful as we've ever been. And it's easy to become somewhat inured to the superlatives and the statements of success. And yet today, we really don't have any other alternative but to try again to describe how much more we accomplished on this flight than one could have believed possible a year ago or so. We went into this flight saying that this was one of the most challenging missions that we've ever undertaken, and that it would be somewhat fortunate if we actually managed to accomplish all of the objectives. And yet here we stand today, having accomplished virtually every task that was on the nominal mission list and one or two additional ones that we threw in when it was convenient to do that. And the work, again, puts us in a good posture with the Hubble Space Telescope to continue its dramatic science. And while the telescope is heralded as probably the most productive science instrument that the agency has ever produced or that mankind has ever produced, I'd like to also call some attention to the synergy between the manned spaceflight program and the unmanned operation of spacecraft. And the ability to service the telescope, to keep advancing the state of the art on the telescope and to keep it scientifically relevant is really the premier example of the synergy between those two branches of our space program. It's been a great pleasure to work with the team from the manned space flight operations side as well as from the unmanned group, and it's produced a fabulous success for the agency and for the country. So I think, again, congratulations are due to the team, and we're very proud for the success of this mission. Thanks.
Ken?
Well, Phil is right. This was a beautiful, wonderful conclusion to an amazing servicing mission. I've been here for all four of the Hubble servicing missions, and each time we've sat at this dais and told you how difficult the servicing was going to be, the tasks were challenging, and each time this team has made it seem simple. But it really isn't. It's not easy. These are difficult tasks, and we've had 18 now, over four servicing missions, 18 successful spacewalks were on the Hubble Space Telescope, and it's been made to look easy because of three reasons. One, the quality of this team, an exceptional group of very talented engineers, scientists, technicians, operators that make all this come together. Very dedicated group of people. I wouldn't hesitate to put them against any task that you can imagine that needs to be done. And that group consisted, of course, the flight crew, the Johnson Space Center, support staff here that provides the shuttle, which gives us the ability to service such a vehicle as Hubble. The Goddard Project and all the support staff that they have, the support contractors and subcontractors that support the Hubble Space Telescope Project at Goddard. The Space Telescope Science Institute, which is part of that project but operates through Johns Hopkins University. The European Space Agency, our partners in this mission. They provided not only hardware, but they provide people, support, both at the Space Telescope Science Institute as well as supporting preparations for servicing. And lastly but not least, the universities, where the principal investigators are located, the scientists, they provide not only instruments, but of course the analysis of the wonderful data that comes from Hubble. The second reason that this is made to look so easy is the planning. We don't really see, or you don't see, all of the hours of work that go behind each task that goes on. Every task, as Brian said, is choreography. It's almost like a production where every movement and every task has to be looked at carefully to understand how it's done, what tools are necessary to make it happen. And all that's put together, many, many hours behind each task. And thirdly is the training. The people, the planning, and the training. Certainly the crew itself goes through training in the water tank and then at the high-fidelity simulator and examining the flight hardware. But the ground system, the ground people also, the ground support people go through many training exercises to prepare for these flights. So the people, the training, and the planning make it all seem much simpler than it really is. We'll be back in about 2.5 years to do this again, the Hubble fifth servicing mission, which is SM4, and we'll have to figure out a way to explain that to the public, how the fifth mission could be SM4, but that's what we plan to do in a couple of years here. And it will be challenging also. We'll be telling you the same thing again. It'll be challenging, and I trust this team will also make it happen. One of the prime reasons why this coming mission, will be challenging is because it's planned to be the last servicing mission during the lifetime of Hubble. It must prepare the telescope to go 6 years without further servicing until it's the end of its planned 20-year lifetime in the year 2010. The Office of Space Science is committed to have the Next Generation Space Telescope ready by 2010, and we will see the baton then pass from Hubble with 8 more years of wonderful discoveries. There's plenty to come from Hubble, but the plans are to have the baton pass to the Next Generation all in 2010. I'll turn it over to Preston now to talk more about today's activity.
Okay, thank you, Ken. Well, today's redeployment of Hubble from the Space Shuttle Columbia went very smoothly. This is the fifth time now that we have deployed Hubble on orbit from a space shuttle. It's a very complex series of activities that requires a lot of careful coordination between the astronaut crew in the shuttle, the operations folks here at Johnson Space Center, and the operations people at the Goddard Space Flight Center. The Hubble itself is inherently complex, and so this operation is also complex. And so we were having spent 5 days doing a lot of hard work upgrading the telescope. We didn't take anything for granted in making sure that we went about this activity today very thoroughly and very competently. The team did a marvelous job, and everything went as planned.
Right now, the observatory is in excellent condition. Everything is checked out fine, and we're going to begin now our activity that we call Servicing Mission Operations Verification, or Orbital Verification, to check out the new equipment more thoroughly and to get the observatory up and running to do some science. I just want to re-echo the words of Ken and Brian and Phil that the redeployment really reflected, I think, the tremendous cooperation and teamwork that's existed throughout the mission between the NASA folks at Kennedy and Johnson and Goddard, the European Space Agency, private industry, the Science Institute, and academia. It's a huge team, and it's, it takes a tremendous effort to get all the necessary activities properly coordinated. Today we said goodbye to Hubble with mixed emotions. We were glad that servicing mission 3B was successfully accomplished and that Hubble is now ready to go back to work to continue to expand our knowledge of the cosmos with its vastly increased capabilities. But we also have that empty feeling that one gets when saying goodbye to a friend or a relative after a visit of several days. As Ken mentioned, the next servicing mission will be in about 2 years, and it'll be a great challenge with a lot of hard work, and all of us are looking forward to our next visit with Hubble. And as Brian mentioned, after we saw Hubble kind of disappear from view on the television coming down from the orbiter as we were leaving the Operations Control Center at Johnson, it was a very stirring sight to go out in the parking lot and to see Columbia fly overhead with Hubble in trail. It was a pretty amazing thing. So that's about it for me, and let Dave fill you in on the science perspective.
Thanks, Preston, and good morning. I, like all of my colleagues, about 5:30 this morning went outside and looked up and saw the deployed Hubble trailing behind Columbia and moving in tandem across the sky. And the thought I had at the time was that that sort of symbolizes what this is all about, the strong working relationship and coupling between the human spaceflight enterprise and the robotic spaceflight enterprise within NASA. And the scientific community owes a huge debt of gratitude to the NASA civil servants, to our contractors, to our colleagues in academia, who not only bring great professionalism to this activity, but who just work very, very hard, and who make tremendous personal sacrifice, and whose families make tremendous personal sacrifice to enable something as complex and important as the servicing mission to go on. And I thought it might be worthwhile to summarize what we collectively have accomplished with Hubble, not just in this mission and looking forward to the remainder of Hubble's lifetime, but over the past 12 years with Hubble. Every year we look at a metric, which I'm not going to go into now, but it's a way of quantifying how the space science programs of NASA hold up in the whole world of science, all areas of science, not just space science, but chemistry, archaeology, all areas of science from all over the world. How well are we, NASA, doing? And by this metric, Hubble is the most productive and has space mission, science mission, and has had the highest impact of all NASA science missions in the history of the agency. And that's an accomplishment of this team. Without the servicing that we've done and the refurbishment and upgrades of the technology on Hubble that we've done, this would not continue to be the case, but it does continue to be the case year by year. I should comment that the current demand for the use of Hubble by astronomers all around the world exceeds our ability to satisfy that demand by a factor of 8. For every orbit that we're able to assign to an astronomer to observe with Hubble, 8 orbits are proposed by astronomers. And those are usually very high quality proposals, and it's just very painful to have to reject some because there's just not enough observing time in the telescope to accommodate everyone who would like to use it. And this factor of 8 is a record. That's the highest it's ever been for Hubble. And I attribute that to the eager anticipation the community has for using the Advanced Camera for Surveys, which is going to be this tremendously powerful new tool that has been successfully inserted on Hubble during this mission. And we can just hardly wait to get our hands on it. The astronomical community can hardly wait to get its collective hands on it. Another metric that we could point to is that when we resume the science operations after we finish checking out the telescope now that we've deployed. And in a few weeks, we begin collecting science data, and Hubble goes back into normal science operations. The rate of data output from the observatory will be 20 times greater than the original rate of output back in the early 1990s after Hubble was first launched. And after our next servicing mission, servicing mission 4, when we will again upgrade the instrumentation capabilities on Hubble and broaden them to create a more complementary and consistent set of observing capabilities, after that mission, the data output in terms of gigabytes of data per month produced by the observatory will be 44 times higher than it was at the beginning of the mission. And several years after the beginning of the mission with the initial suite of instruments. This is a combination of improvement in instrument technology that makes this possible, plus very clever use of the telescope and its systems in the way they're scheduled so that we make maximum use of the time we have available to us. Hubble is the most frequently cited space mission within the scientific literature. It's also the most frequently cited space science mission within the media. It's a national icon. I dare say it's the most widely recognized space science mission that NASA has ever had in the general public. And a beautiful outcome of that is that Hubble has inspired kids to go into science, and we have clear evidence of that just from the correspondence we have with the children of America and the great opportunities we have to go visit them in their classrooms. I'd like to conclude this little list by saying that we've looked back over the past 12 years and tried to judge what areas of scientific research Hubble has had the greatest impact on. And we come up with a top 10 list of highest impact research areas from Hubble. And if you look at those top 10 research areas, four of them, 40%, were not anticipated at the time Hubble was first launched. And at the time Hubble was launched, we had a little slogan, conscious expectation of the unexpected. And that has certainly proven to be the case, that sort of at the 4 out of 10 level, we're doing science today we couldn't have dreamed of doing in 1990. And that, frankly, is the way science is done. That's the way it happens. That's the way it progresses. And I trust that 5 or 8 years from now, that'll still be the case. We'll be working on problems that we didn't know how to ask about today. And this is, again, a tribute to the entire team that has worked so long and hard to bring this mission off. And the scientific community will be eternally grateful to those people. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. We'll go down to the Kennedy Space Center now for questions.
This is Marcia Dunn of the Associated Press with a quick question for Brian. How much time does the crew actually get off tonight? Is it a full half day in terms of their work day?
It's approximately a half a day, yes.
Thank you. And well, I guess another quick question for you. I couldn't help but overhear the conversation between the two spaceships in orbit. Do you have any idea what the distance between the shuttle and the station was at the time of contact?
It's, Marcia, 7,200 nautical miles. I believe the station's going to be over the South Pacific and the shuttle over the Atlantic at the time.
I was referring to this morning's conversation.
No, forget that.
I don't know.
Thank you. And I guess for Preston, are tests, even as we speak, continuing on all the telescope systems? Could you just sort of talk over any milestones over the next couple of days or a week?
Okay. One of the things that we always do after a servicing mission is recalibrate all of the attitude control sensors on Hubble. We'll go through some very detailed measurements on the gyroscopes on Hubble, the fixed head star trackers, and the fine guidance sensors to make sure that they're all properly aligned. And there are a lot of aspects to their performance that are critical to maintaining the high precision pointing capability of the telescope. So that's certainly one area that we'll be focusing on. Of course, we're very keen to want to get our previously existing science instruments, the Wide Field Planetary Camera 2 and STIS, up and running as soon as possible. And so those will be activated, I believe, with PICTOS through a decontamination procedure. Temperatures need to be adjusted. We need to double check on focus and alignment and that sort of thing. And those two instruments will be back doing productive science within approximately 2.5 weeks or so. And then, of course, we begin the checkout process on the NICMOS instrument itself along with the advanced camera for surveys, and then the NICMOS cooling system. And those procedures, because NICMOS has been off for so long, and because the cooling system and ACS are so new, there's a lot of work to be done there in terms of checking those systems out thoroughly and getting them properly adjusted, focused, calibrated, et cetera. And so that's several weeks of activity. So that's the main thrust of what we'll be doing over the next several weeks.
Todd Halverson of Space.com for Dr. McCrone. I was interested in knowing whether you guys have any idea yet of what your first targets will be for the advanced camera for surveys.
Well, I think the Advanced Camera for Surveys team has made it known that that's a deep, dark secret. It is true that we've gone through a discussion of candidate targets. We have a list of candidate targets. We think we will be able to schedule most of them, although you never know for sure. It depends on the constraints on the spacecraft and so forth. I think you'll be very pleased to see the outcome of those observations, but I'm not going to be the one to tell you what the targets are right now.
Okay, I understand. Can you give me an idea of what type of celestial mysteries that camera might go after? What type of studies it would be tasked with when it first becomes operational?
Right. Well, I'm sure when it first becomes operational, the scientists are going to want to bore right into the most important questions that they've identified for this instrument, and that includes certainly the way galaxies evolve out as far back across back in time and across the universe as we're able to see, and we definitely will be able to see deeper across the universe than the prior Hubble cameras. This instrument will be used for an extensive survey of this phenomenon called gravitational lensing, by which distant galaxies, the light passing nearby foreground galaxies or clusters of galaxies, is bent and focused into lensed images by the mass in that foreground cluster or nearby galaxy. This is, I think Holland Ford has called this God's telescope. This is a mechanism by which nature itself provides us a way to look at fainter objects than we would be able to see otherwise. It's a phenomenon that's a consequence of Einstein's theory of relativity, and it's very well established. We've done a lot of observing with prior Hubble cameras in this area, but the Advanced Camera for Surveys will be a real powerhouse in picking out weak lensing, faint lensed objects, and from that sorting out the distribution of cold dark matter in the universe. And those are just a couple of examples. There's a very fine coronagraph in this instrument that will be used, if not to detect planets around stars, at least to very thoroughly study the protoplanetary material around stars from which new planets could be born. So those are several areas that we could go on for several hours, I think, discussing the potential.
Thanks. And for either you or Preston, I know this mission was really oversubscribed, but I was curious as to whether there was ever any consideration given to bringing CoSTAR back on this mission, since it really isn't going to be used anymore.
I'll try that. And then you can try that, or vice versa.
Yeah.
CoSTAR is occupying a slot in instrument bay, and even though it's not in active scientific use anymore, it does provide a thermal mass and structural support and so forth within that bay. You would not want to leave Hubble with an empty instrument bay. And so CoSTAR is reserving the space for an instrument that will be flown in the next servicing mission, the Cosmic Origin Spectrograph, which will be the most sensitive spectrograph ever flown in space. And again, will be a good, powerful time machine doing spectroscopy on objects that are very far away and very far back in time. So we want to leave CoSTAR in space just to kind of take up the space and help maintain stability within the ash shroud of the Hubble, and then wait and look forward to the Cosmic Origin Spectrograph.
That's a very good explanation, if I can jump in here, but there's also one additional thing I can point out, and that is if we were to bring CoSTAR back on the servicing mission that we just concluded, we would have had to provide a carrier and a protective enclosure for it, and so we'd be bringing something home on this mission that would require extra space and extra weight and extra time also on this mission. And then when we go to deliver the Cosmic Origin Spectrograph on the next mission, we'd be using the same structure and container, so it just doesn't make for a very efficient operation. We're much better off just holding off, leaving CoStar up there and swapping out CoStar with COS in a, using one single delivery system and doing it in an efficient way.
Thanks. And for Brian Austin, I know you're not an entry guy, but can you give us an idea of when Freon Coolant Loop 1 will come up on landing day and what the game plan will be if the coolant flow drops to the rate you saw on launch day or even below that?
Well, both Freon loops are continually active. That loop has been active all the way from the beginning, from before launch and all the way up through now. So they're both loops are still running. It's just running at that degraded flow that we've had since the post the ascent and then now through our orbit operations, and it'll be in that same general reduced flow, and but still with the between it and along with the other loop, very sufficient capacity to handle entry. So it's been up and running, and we'll stay in that configuration. We have, like I mentioned a number of days back, they'll reconfigure some of the system to put us back in the, when we close the doors and reconfigure back to similar to that ascent configuration, and there we'll have a different flow rate, but that's just consistent with a smaller loop process, if you will. But everything's fine with that, and it's up and running.
If I could add one other
thing. I guess what I meant is that, you know, obviously it's more of a player on landing day than it is during on-orbit operations, and I was curious as to what the course of action would be if, in fact, you saw flow rates drop to below what they did on launch day.
Okay. Well, Brian and I were just commenting here. It's important to remember we have two Freon loops, and the other loop is still operating at 100% capacity. Either loop by itself would be capable of sustaining the entry loads. The only concern we had early in the mission would be the availability of the degraded loop if the other loop were lost. Since we're still at essentially nominal condition with the other loop, there really isn't an entry thermal loads concern.
And with the last question from KSC, I was wondering, Brian, if there was an early outlook for weather on landing day.
I don't know that just yet. I know you'll get a chance to talk to the entry flight director here in a day or so. I can't tell you that right now. Focus has been on the weather up in space and the conditions for the EVAs, and as you can see, the weather's pretty good there.
We'll check on the headlines in a few moments, but as we take a break, let's take a look at the newly renovated Hubble Telescope. The U.S. Space Shuttle Columbia has released the Hubble Telescope from its grip, sending the orbiting observatory on its way with what NASA hopes is a clearer view of the universe. For several days, the Hubble was berthed in Columbia's cargo bay, while astronauts conducted a series of upgrades, including refurbishing the telescope's 12-year-old camera and installing a high-tech cooling system. NASA says the first images from the improved Hubble should be available in early May. The crew of the Space Shuttle Columbia has released the Hubble Space Telescope back into orbit. The astronauts conducted five successful spacewalks and upgraded the observatory's cameras and power systems. For 12 years, the Hubble Telescope has provided astronomers with revealing images of space they could never see otherwise. The telescope is expected to stay in operation for at least another 8 years. Our space correspondent, Miles O'Brien, recaps the highlights of the shuttle mission.
I'm going to hold here until I'm flat.
The week of walks began with wings, solar wings. Hubble's 9-year-old models had lost some oomph and were vibrating in the wild temperature swings of low Earth orbit. Vibrations are the enemy of clear images. During a pair of nearly identical spacewalks, the teams of John Grunsfeld and Rick Linehan and Jim Newman and Mike Massimino removed and stole the old solar arrays, which rolled up like window shades. They attach some new rigid arrays that are smaller yet able to produce 20% more electricity. And they replaced a bulky gyroscope. That set the stage for one of the tensest moments for Hubbleistas since the mission to correct the telescope's blurry vision in 1993.
I'll try to get in as close as I can with good clearances on the left and center.
For the first time since it was launched, Hubble was turned off for 4.5 hours while Grunsfeld and Linehan swapped out the telescope's power control unit. The heart transplant was a success, and Hubble was left with ample power to run its instruments during what scientists hope will be another 8 years in orbit. With Hubble's health improved, the astronauts focused on its scientific well-being.
And these are slow enough for this.
The spacewalkers installed a new instrument with some great potential. The advanced camera for surveys is 10 times more powerful than the current workhorse on Hubble, which gets the photo credit for images of the most distant galaxies ever seen. The new camera is likely to extend Hubble's reach even deeper into the cosmos. The spacewalkers also worked to bring an idle Hubble instrument back online.
Looks like a big surfboard, John.
The NICMOS infrared camera operates at very low temperatures, 100 degrees below zero Celsius. So when its cooling system failed 3 years ago, the instrument was shut down. The astronauts installed a new $21 million cooler that should allow astronomers to see the universe through infrared colored glasses. NASA had reason to be rosy after watching this mission unfold. Hubble, once a laughingstock, is rewriting the astronomy textbooks, defining the age and expansion of the universe, spotting black holes, seeing stars at their birth and death. Scientists say Hubble is at the vanguard of a golden age of astronomy, and they are thanking their lucky stars. Miles O'Brien, CNN.
And we'll be back with the headlines in a moment. Stay with us.